All right. Good morning, everyone. Thanks so much for spending this rainy day with us. There's nowhere else you'd rather be, right? I mean, it's not like you can go golfing, so we're good. My name is Allie McGinty. I'm an HR consultant with Marsh & McLennan Agency, and this is Jen Tourovel. She's also an HR consultant. So we work very closely together with a lot of our clients and managers, so either HR or managers, in regards to HR. We're going to start out by a video. Jen and I are super informal by nature, so if you're expecting really stiff presenters, this isn't the place to be, because we want you guys to laugh, we want you guys to interact with us, because otherwise we're going to get bored, okay? And then what I also want you to do, if you only have two people at your table, if you wouldn't mind going to another table or inviting someone to your table, or if people are walking in, just because I want to make sure that you have an opportunity to network, right? That's the best thing that we can do, is we can network with other people who are in the same boat as us, because then we can learn from each other. So you'll notice there's some pinwheels in front of you. Don't be intimidated. We're going to do a little activity with those later on. But we're going to get started by watching a quick little video.
We are trying to do everything humanly possible to help you.
I will do everything humanly possible to help you. I will take care.
Can you please tell me about yourself?
How would you rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 10?
Can you describe yourself in a single word?
Describe yourself in 3 words.
What would you do if you're stuck in an island with a dog and a knife? What would you do if you're stuck in an island with a dog, a boy, a parachute, a parakeet, a girl, and a knife? We will get back to you on that.
We'll get back to you on that.
This is not an HR's job. HRs need not conduct interviews. See, the company is like this donut. An HR is the whole. We define the organization.
At this esteemed organization, we believe in gender equality. All genders are equal.
Here, we create a synergy to leverage on your opportunity.
We believe in diversity and inclusion. Diverse people are also included.
We want you to be like this water bottle. It should be reusable.
Work-life balance. That is why we insist on compulsory leave every Sunday.
Like this water. You should be able to change shape.
To succeed in the organization, you need the 3 R's.
Resilience, rigor,
and right path. You should also have the 4 P's.
Potential, perseverance, passion,
pasteurization, and the 17 C's.
Commitment,
consciousness,
cerebral dominance,
cell phones,
chastity,
commodities,
cable TV,
cupcakes,
cafeteria,
cashew nuts,
constipation,
cabin crew,
cabinet minister,
C-section,
and Kim Kardashian. See, the organization is like an ocean, and the employees are like a fish. Smaller employees are small fish, bigger employees are big fish. We HR are the dam.
Anybody think that might be the perception of HR sometimes? Yeah. So, you know, how many of you guys are in HR versus how many of you guys are managers? So if you're in HR, raise your hand. Okay, perfect. We put your hands down. How many of you guys are managers? Okay, good. So we have a good group here. So we're gonna kind of talk about, you know, some HR things that we can do. For those of you who have been in the industry or have been in HR for quite a while, you'll learn some things and have some takeaways. But we're really gonna just kind of approach it through the employment life cycle of really what is the life of an employee. What I want you to do, though, is, because earlier I said networking was really important, right? So what I want you to do is introduce yourself to everybody at your table. Tell them what your name is. Tell them how many years you've been in the industry that you're in, where you work, and then also what your biggest challenge is. So what are the biggest challenges that you face either as HR or manager? So everybody talk to your friends at your table and introduce yourself. All right, I'm going to bring you guys back. I love the talking and the networking that's going on. Did you guys feel like, thank gosh, someone else is in the same boat as me? Anybody else have that misery loves company kind of thing going on? Yeah? What were some of the challenges that you guys came up with as a table, regardless if you were a manager or HR? Did you say recruiting? Yeah. How many of us are having problems recruiting right now? I'm surprised that none of you, all of you raised your hands. That's great that some of you have nailed that concept. It's a tough market out there, absolutely. Good. We'll talk a little bit about that today as well. What else? Constant growth. That's a good problem, but it's definitely a challenge, right? So is it having the right staff, having people get on board, having employees go through the stages of change and go through it? Absolutely, we change, remove their cheese, right? And so now we have to help them get through that. Yeah, absolutely. What else? I think someone had their hand raised back there. Yeah.
Well, staying current with the regs that we discussed.
Yeah.
They can avoid stepping on landmines.
That's true, right? Regulations, those, everything, right? It's like they're out there just to make sure that we don't sleep at night. Absolutely. Good. What else? Anything else that we missed? Anybody have employee issues? Yeah.
We were talking about
yeah, absolutely. That's a great one. Don't shoot the messenger. Yeah, good. But that's great. Yeah, have building those relationships with the decision makers so that you can remain effective and have an influence in the organization. Absolutely. Anything else we missed? Okay, well, we'll get started here. So today our agenda is really going to talk through the employment life cycle. So everything that you see throughout the presentation, we'll talk about recruitment and selection. We'll talk about onboarding and orientation, retention engagement, employee services, so the daily maintenance of just having employees, and then performance management, and then separation and termination. We'll take some breaks throughout, but if you feel like you have to get up, you're not a prisoner, so please do feel free to get up and go to the bathroom, or if you like to stand, sometimes I get antsy sitting, feel free to go against the back wall and stand by any means. So what I want you guys to do is we're gonna do another quick activity that I promise we'll get into some content, but what do you think of when you think of a leader that you truly admire? Think about someone that you look at as a leader, and what is it that you truly admire about that person? It can be in your organization. It can be a past leader. It doesn't have to be. Whoever you think about. What is it about that person that inspires you? So talk to the person next to you. I'm going to give you just 2 minutes to do that. But just say some qualities. Just name off some different qualities that you think of when you think of a true leader. All right, I want you guys to yell out some qualities. What are qualities of leaders that truly inspire you? Just yell them out. Oh, that's mine too. I like that one. Yeah, good. Consistency. Consistency. Respect.
Openness.
Openness. Yeah, absolutely.
Motivation.
Motivation. The ability to motivate employees. Yeah, good.
Positivity.
Very key, right? Mm-hmm. Anything else?
Honesty and integrity.
Absolutely. Well, I want you guys to keep these in mind, because as we go through the presentation, think about how can I change or how can I continue to develop in some of these areas, keeping those traits in mind. Never when I ask someone who a good leader is, do they ever say, I really think the leader, they were great because they micromanaged me and they put me down and they criticized me and they told me all the things I was doing wrong, right? It's about how you approach the message. It's someone that you really feel like you can lead. It's not someone who necessarily manages you, but it's someone who leads you. And so we'll talk about that going forward today. But then what we're going to do is we're going to actually have Jen talk about discrimination, because I think that's the foundation of what we need to know. We need to know some of those employment laws that are around us that we really need to make sure that we're not stepping on those landmines that you mentioned. So I'm going to turn it over to Jen.
Thanks, Allie. Is this on? Can you all hear me? Okay. Allie got to do all the fun part. Now I get to talk about employment law, right? How boring. I promise I'll try not to bore you to tears and put you to sleep. But let's start off by talking about discrimination. So what is discrimination? We've thrown the definition up there on the board for you. And it really is treating people differently than you treat other people. That's just the basics of what discrimination is. Making employment decisions based upon a protected class. So from a federal law standpoint, there's a bunch of federal laws that protect us as employees. And some of the protected classes and characteristics that they protect us within are up on the board there. And we don't want to make employment decisions based on any of these protected classes or characteristics. What do employment decisions need to be based on? Do you guys know? Did I hear skills over there? Skills. What else?
Qualifications.
Yep.
Merit.
Education. Yep. Those are all things we can make employment decisions on. So the federal law protects us as employees. The state takes it a step further. You got to click through all these, Allie. It's really fun. There's 13 of them. There, you're done. So Minnesota protects employees in 13 areas. So Minnesota takes it a step further than the federal government. There's a few that are the same, and Minnesota has sprinkled in a couple of additional ones. So we listed them out here for you. Minnesota protects us in the area of age. So we can't make unfair employment decisions based on someone's age.
That in Minnesota also talks about you can't say they're too young, right? So federal law says you can't discriminate over 40 years of age.
Yep.
Minnesota protects all ages. So if you're 18 or older, you can't say, yeah, we're not going to hire the salesperson. We think they're a little bit too young, right?
Yep.
That's not a justification.
Yep. From a federal standpoint, it's 40, and a lot of my friends are reminding me that I'm closely nearing another protected class, which is really nice. Color, treating someone unfavorably because of their skin color. How about creed? Does anybody know what creed is? It's up on the board, so it's cheating, but. Yep. It's treating someone different because of their set of fundamental beliefs. It's not just religion. If somebody was a vegetarian, that's creed. That's a set of fundamental beliefs. Disability, treating someone differently because they have a disability. It doesn't even have to be a disability that you can see, right? Okay. Familial status. If somebody has a family or minors living with them or is in the process of securing minors to live with them from like a foster or legal custody standpoint or even pregnancy. Local Human Rights Commission activity, that would be if somebody has made a claim of discrimination. So treating them differently because they've made that claim. Marital status, treating someone differently because of their marital status. Single, married, divorced, it covers all of them. National origin, we might be treating someone differently based on where they're born. Public assistance, if we treat somebody differently because of a public assistance status. Race, treating someone unfavorably because they belong to a certain race or have characteristics that are associated with a certain race. Religion, treating someone differently because of a religion or lack thereof. Sex, treating someone differently because of their sex and sexual orientation. Either, and that can be a perception as well. So Minnesota takes it, like I said, a step further than the federal law takes it. Federal law protects employees. Minnesota has an additional 13 from our Minnesota Human Rights Act that protect us.
So if you want some reading this weekend, Minnesota Human Rights Act.
Or if you want something
just kidding
to put you to sleep. So the federal law oversees us, the EEOC. Employees have 180 days to file a claim with the EEOC. Now, in age or in states that have fair employment practices, employees could have up to 300 days. Depending on the state, depending on the claim.
So that's a big implication for us as HR folks.
Yep.
And managers, right? So if we don't take action or we don't pay attention to this or we don't educate managers or managers aren't aware, they don't do something, it's not one of those things that we could say, well, they didn't do anything, it happened a week ago, it's irrelevant. They have almost half a year to do something about it, right? So
yep.
It's really important that we take these claims as serious, and we'll talk through that. And take good notes, because these things can come back to haunt us. And I don't know about you guys, but I don't remember what happened last month, let alone 180 days ago or 300 days ago.
Exactly. Yep, so we need to make sure we document everything. And we're going to talk a lot about documentation today. Here's some stats from the EEOC website. 89,000 claims were made in 2015. And you might say, Jen, the math doesn't really add up there. And it's not just because I'm bad at math. It's because people might file claims in multiple areas. So 89,000 claims were filed. We're paying out a lot of money, folks. Look at this. Statistics behind harassment in 2015. almost 28,000 sexual harassment cases were brought forward. And almost $126 million was paid out. And this is something that we're seeing more and more of. In 2014, there was a roughly 88,000 EEOC claims, like you saw in 2015, 89,300. But look at what's happened since 2005 with retaliation charges. Again, something the EEOC monitors. From 2005 to 2015, look at the growth there in the number of retaliation claims and the dollar amount that's being paid out. It's pretty staggering, isn't it?
Jen, can we talk about retaliation for just a second?
Absolutely.
So for managers out there, so what retaliation is, it doesn't have to be actually that you are retaliating against an employee or making an adverse employment action because they brought a claim forward, but it could be the appearance of it. So we really need to be cognizant, and we'll talk about mindfulness later, of the actions and the words that we say, because it could get us in trouble, right? And even though it's not our intention, I would say most of the time it's not our intention, but it's the impact.
Yep, absolutely.
So harassment, what is that, right? Because we hear people say it all the time, I'm being harassed. I hear it all the time. I'm like, well, tell me more about that. What does that mean? And it's because a lot of people don't really know what the actual definition of harassment is. And what the definition is, it's unwelcome conduct that is based on protected characteristics. And it's the act of systemic or continued unwanting annoying actions of one party or group. And there's two types of harassment, right? There's sexual harassment, which I think we think about a lot of the time, where it's touching, groping, making comments. But then there's also non-sexual harassment. The most important thing that I want you guys to know is about this slide up here. It has to be unwelcome, and it has to be against a person's protected characteristic. So if I am saying something to Jen, we're both females. What am I saying it based off, right? We're very similar. There's no protected characteristic that I'm saying, unless I'm saying, Jen, you're really approaching that 40 mark, right? Then that might be some fighting words.
I don't like
words.
That very much.
I know, right? So, but that's it, right? It has to be unwelcome. That was unwelcome. But unless it's against a protected characteristic, it's not harassment. And that's, I think, where a lot of times our employees just throw out that. I'm being harassed. Anybody else have that? Where people just misuse that word? And so it's an education that we really need to teach employees that that's what it is, right? Because a lot of times they come in and they might be like, I'm being bullied or I'm being harassed. This is a hostile work environment. And we really need to know what those definitions are, not only so we can educate them, but so we can create foster an environment that people want to be at, and then also so we're reducing our litigation issues. So, okay, that's my number one rule. I want you guys to remember that. That's where I see people get confused a lot. And then the conduct must be considered abusive to the person affected, right? So the law actually says it's the reasonable person standard, and it's from what the person who's experiencing the conduct feels. So saying, well, that wasn't my intention, isn't an excuse, right? The law doesn't care if you didn't intend to do it. It's about the reasonable person standard. So what would a jury say? It also doesn't say, gosh, we have the most sensitive employees ever. Are they going to take this to the extreme? If it goes to court, it'd be what is a reasonable person say in that situation? And so after it's unwelcome and after it's against a protected characteristic, they take into consideration the frequency of it happening, the severity, if it's physically threatening, if it's humiliating, how it's affecting work performance, and then how it's affecting that employee's well-being. This is a staggering statistic. 1 in 10 employees have been physically assaulted by a coworker or manager. Think about how many employees that you guys have in your organization. What percentage is that for you? That's a lot of information. And Jen and I have spent a lot of time lately looking into workplace bullying because that's kind of a newer thing that people are talking about, and we'll show you some more information on that later. But really, it's alarming how many people actually experience it and how many people don't say things. So if you think about if you're having a hard time recruiting right now and you don't want to lose your good employees, stopping these things is a great way to do that. Because those people who don't want to say anything are just going to get up and leave and go to another organization. And you don't even have a chance to stop it then.
Yep. And one thing to add on to that, studies show that your top 10% of employees will leave if there is harassment, discrimination, offensive behaviors going on in your workplace. So think about that. Can you afford to lose your top 10%, your top performers?
That's why it's so important that we create this a culture where people want to be it safe and people feel comfortable coming to work and actually being able to do their job. So workplace bullying, again, this you probably heard something of it. People who work in schools, it's a requirement to have workplace bullying for, you know, the students and the teachers so everybody's aware of it. And there's more to talk about doing it at a state level, and we'll talk about that. But what is workplace bullying, right? So when people say I'm being harassed, if it's not against a protected characteristic, it could be bullying, right? And you might have bullying policies in your handbook. Anybody have a bullying policy? Yeah. I recommend you put something in there, right? Especially in your code of conduct, that you have something that talks a little bit about this issue so that if it does happen, you can take an employment decision based on it. And so bullying is repeated abuse that creates psychological power imbalance and the inability for the targets to defend themselves. So it's things like cyberbullying. So, you know, we talk about texting. It could be emailing. It doesn't have to just be yelling and fighting at someone's face. Mm-hmm. So here's a really alarming statistic. I think the first time that I saw this, I was like, oh, my gosh, are you kidding? 65 million workers are affected by workplace bullying each year. That's the equivalent to the combined populations of these 15 states that are bullied. Is anybody else surprised about that? Yeah, because here I was thinking, I'm like, oh, my niece, you know, she goes to school, tells me about all the kids, and I think, hey, we go to school, it happens on the playground, it happens on the bus, and then we grow up, and then it stops. But unfortunately, it doesn't. It filters into our workplace, and then it creates the cycle, right? So it's really important for us to know that this is happening, this is a real issue, and we need to address it. If you look at this chart right here, the Workplace Bullying Institute does a survey. The most recent one they have is 2014 data. And 20% of the population has been bullying. 23% are aware bullying happened. 21% have witnessed it. And currently, 7% are being bullied themselves. Right? I don't know about you, but I wouldn't want to work in that work environment. And I'm not saying it's happening in yours. I'm just saying a lot of us don't realize that it's happening under our house, and we really need to be aware of that. Here's another chart up here for you guys to see. This isn't in your graph, but we will definitely send this out for you guys to see it. But there are different 31 legislators that have introduced bills about workplace bullying. And so they're trying to do it at a state level, not a federal level, because of the money that it would take from government. But what they're trying to do is do it at a state level and even a county level so that there are some laws against bullying in the workplace or some regulations. So be aware of that, right? So it's out there. People are trying to pass laws. There's groups that are trying to make this happen. So there aren't any actual laws today, but there are some related laws and things like that out there. So just be aware.
Yep. And it's a complex issue. It's a hot topic. We hear a lot about it, like Allie said, in schools. We're going to continue to hear more and more about it in our workplaces. Probably before any of us are lucky enough to retire, I would say we're going to see more and more about this. All right, so let's move on to recruitment and selection. So some of you raised your hands when we talked about the war on talent.
This is how people do it now, Nikki. They have their interviews on the internet.
I like it.
I know child.
Okay, here they are. And when I hit this, they'll be able to see us. So come on and get in here close so we can be seen in the webcam. See how small the webcam is? No, get your cheek. Nick, come here.
Okay, but don't crowd me.
We can see you guys.
Okay, good.
You got us?
Hi, my name is Billy. Oh,
we can hear you fine as well.
Oh, great.
Good.
Billy McMahon.
Nick Campbell.
I'm Benjamin.
Allison, we're going to ask you a few questions that some of our candidates find a little bit odd.
Let's get weird.
No judgment, shoot.
You're shrunken down to the size of nickels and dropped to the bottom of a blender. What do?
You take her flat on your back like
right.
this.
You just lay back, enjoy that
as a
breeze.
Board, light as a feather,
pretend it's a fan.
And let those okay, bad waves whip all around you like this. It's like getting an MRI.
Once this blender's on, it's on forever.
It's on.
Respectfully, I gotta disagree. We sold blenders, and even the best model in the world is only gonna run maybe 10 or 11 hours. So we're getting out, and when we do, we're better off for it, because whatever doesn't kill you makes you stronger.
It's not so much getting out of the blender, it's what happens next. That's the question.
You've got two nickel-sized men free in the world. Think of the possibilities.
I mean, I on top of my head, and I'm just
spitballing
here.
Swimming.
Sunglass repair? We'd be hell on those little screws.
Or maybe stick us in those submarines that they put in people's bodies to fight diseases.
Okay, that's not a real thing, the submarines.
No.
Wait a minute. I thought we were stuck in a blender. Now we're saving lives? What?
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 What? What?
Let me just recap this for you real quick. We start off in a blender.
Yeah.
Now we're saving lives. What?
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 Wait a minute. We were stuck in a blender.
What a journey.
And now we're saving lives? What?
You guys led us to this. Thank you.
So I like that video because, first of all, we talk about how we're changing times, right? Now we need to be used to doing... Anybody do Skype interviews or Google Hangouts or anything like that? It's a really great way to save travel costs, right? So we have people, if you have an awesome candidate that you want to interview, but you don't want to send them here if you haven't really had an opportunity to have that conversation. You can still have that face-to-face just through Skype, and it's a great opportunity to really get to know candidates before investing a lot of money and saving their time, right? So especially if we're in a quick-to-fill position and we don't have time for them to say, yeah, well, I can't get to your office for a couple weeks, we can do those Skype. So I encourage you guys to think about that as you're going through it. But then obviously, knowing who your candidates are, knowing if they're comfortable with that, asking if they need help, having user guides for them to go through that process as well. All right, so next slide. So some of you raised your hand when we were talking about the war on talent. 2016 is the year of the candidate. We have a population of free agents, and that's not just baseball players. And it's not just millennials. A lot of our employees have this free agent mentality because there's a lot of jobs out there. There's a lot of jobs available. As we approach full employment, employees have more options, and us as employers, we have less options, right? And also something that's going on with the American Healthcare Association is they have a goal to decrease turnover by 2018. And on their website, they have some specific initiatives to help them reach that goal. Because the healthcare industry has extremely high turnover right now, so that's really an initiative of theirs.
Yep, in long-term care, it's about 49% within the first year. It's huge. So the cost of not getting recruitment right, it's kind of one of those hard to measure type things. It's a little bit of an intangible, but when we don't hire the right people, it's costing us a lot of money. Typically, for somebody who's in a salaried position, you know, it can be upwards of 30% to replace them, and that's based on what they make annually. That's a huge cost, because while we have that position vacant, our productivity is going down, and we're also spending money trying to recruit for this position, right? So we're struggling in this part where we can't get recruitment right. I love shocking HR statistics, and I love Kevin from Home Alone. So 53% of job applications contain inaccurate information, so people are beefing it up or falsifying it. 34% contain outright lies. That's scary. 9% of people are putting things on their resume that didn't really even exist. 11% misrepresented why they left their last employer or an employer. And negligent hiring costs us a lot of money. We lose about 79% of the cases that we're involved in from a negligent hiring perspective. And look at that dollar amount, about $40 million. So what is negligent hiring? Basically, we need to make sure we have sound hiring practices, that we're doing our background checks, our reference checks, our drug testing. Because if we knowingly hire somebody who was violent in the workplace or had some other issue, and we bring them into our organization and they cause harm to somebody, we can be on the hook for that.
It's the same with like MVRs, right? If we know that someone had a past history of, you know, DUIs or things like that, and then we hire them and they drive for our job and we never did an MVR, could we have been liable? Should we have known better? Yeah, right? So that could be negligent hiring. So I want to go back to Jen's last slide where we talk about these shocking statistics, just because I want you guys to make me feel better. Have you guys ever hired anybody and been like, who are you? You are not the same person that we interviewed. Right? Yeah, that happens.
Yep,
Thank you. It does, right? So we're going to talk through some of the things that we can do to kind of help eliminate that, because those surprises aren't really that fun, right? Because then we're like, oh my gosh, where did that come from? Yep. So we'll talk through some of that as well.
So really, the purpose of an interview, we want to develop our pipeline, right? And us in HR, we hear our hiring managers, at least I always have when I've been in a recruiting role, build me a pipeline. Well, it's easier said than done, right, HR people? Yes. Okay, not just me. I see some head nodding. We want to find that new talent. We want to find a great culture fit for our organization. We need a succession plan. How many of you are worried a little bit about succession planning? Yeah. Yep. We want people to bring those new, fresh ideas to our company, that fresh perspective. A lot of our new ideas, innovations, come from those new people coming in and looking at our organization through fresh eyes. We also want to bring company awareness, right? We want to be an employer of choice. We want people to know our company as a great place to work. So why is recruiting so difficult? Here's a few reasons why. I think we could probably fill the whole presentation today about why recruiting is so difficult. But it is hard because we have limited time. We all have busy schedules. Our hiring managers have busy schedules. Our candidates, we're trying to coordinate all of that. It's really hard. It's hard to gain quality information. Like Allie said, you hire somebody and then you're like, who the heck is this? This isn't the person that I interviewed. This is a totally different person. How many of you have too many people involved in your hiring process? Too many cooks in the kitchen? Yep, I've been there too. I've had that in
previous
roles.
Everybody needs a say. Everybody needs to hire that
Everybody person. Needs a say, but we need to make sure we're moving fast through the process as well. Legal consequences. We don't want our hiring managers to get us into any sticky situations by saying the wrong things, right? And we're going to talk more about some of that. There's lots of gray area with that being said as well. What can we say? What can't we say? We don't want to be in that icky area. The interview is really the start of the employment life cycle. That's where a lot of engagement comes from, actually, as well. We start building that engagement at the interview. Quality of candidates. In a hot market like we're in right now, we might not have a lot of great candidates out there. So how are we going to find them? And then we've all been there probably where we don't move fast enough or somebody takes another offer and we lose the candidate and we have to either go to our next one or maybe even start the whole process over. And this is why recruiting is so hard.
So it's really important for us to be aware of the process because you think, oh, recruiting, right? Anybody ever have anybody go, recruiting's not that hard? And then do you kind of want to punch them a little bit? Yep. They're like, oh, you just talk to people all day. And I'm like, oh, you don't even know, right? So, yeah, it's not. It's difficult. And, you know, we think, oh, it's just having a conversation, getting to know candidates. But I like when you guys said there's regulations, there's hot buttons everywhere that we're just avoiding stepping on landmines. And so it's important for us as employers to know what that law is behind it. And what happens is we have to know about disparate treatment, right? So disparate treatment is actually intentionally treating people differently. And our actions are to treat them differently, right? So if I think, gosh, I'm not going to hire any women for this position because there's a lot of travel, so I'm only going to hire men, right? So that's who we're recruiting, that's who we're advertising for. Where disparate impact is really where the impact of my intentions or whatever I'm doing has that discrimination. So think about this case right here, where you can barely see it up here, but McCormick had a lawsuit where they had to pay out $1.3 million. And then actually they had to do a whole bunch of different things like training for managers and then actually do affirmative action to recruit some minorities. Because what they actually did was in all of their job postings, they had previously had positions, like they had people, everybody was white in the positions that they posted. So it made it seem like we weren't open to diversity. And there was a whole bunch of other cases like that. But so you can see how there's an easy opportunity just to have disparate impact, even though that's not your intention, right? So are we actually looking at our job postings? Are we saying, hey, come work for us, young, excited, just graduated? Right? We think, hey, we're trying to get more youth to join our organization, right? That's a big part of the population right now. We're trying to attract them. But what's the impact of that? Are we actually turning away candidates because they don't think it appeals to them when it's actually not a job-related characteristic? Does that make sense? Okay. So I think that's what makes employment hard, is because we have to be cognizant of, well, what's the impression that I'm making, right? So it's not what I'm actually doing, but it's also what could someone else think about that, right? So it kind of ties our hands a little bit. So the biggest thing is we have to prepare when we go to an interview. I don't know about you, but when you're running to meetings and if you don't do recruiting all day long, interview is just another hat that you have to wear. And it's really important that we show up prepared for the interviews. So that's having a copy of that applicant's resume. So just like Jen said, that's the first impression that they have of you. And you know, we used to think that, hey, we're interviewing them, they have to impress us. But now it's kind of the opposite, right? We have to impress them because we don't want to lose them. Obviously, you know, they have to impress us still, but we want to make sure that we're sending a good reputation of who we are and sending a good message to them as well. So it's bringing a copy of the job description, right? We all want to know what our expectations are. It's having a candidate profile. So, you know, if you do have a LinkedIn of them, so you're connected with them or whatever it is, having their resumes, even having some notes from other interview managers or the HR person, you don't want to ask the same questions. Candidates are like, you just asked me that, right? Why didn't you guys talk internally? Do you guys have communication issues? Right? Behaviors and competencies, knowing what it takes to be successful in the job. Have you actually done an analysis to say what are our competencies that make someone successful in this role? We have environmental fit. We didn't put culture fit up there because we didn't want you to misinterpret that. But environmental fit, right? Are they going to fit within our organization? If we're a really fast-paced organization and someone says, well, I just need to sit down and I need to take my time and very analytical, that's perfect, right? That's great, but that's good for a different company because we don't operate that way. We just kind of fly by the seat of our pants, right? So that's what it's important to know about environmental fit. Identifying who your interview team is ahead of time and having it be consistent. So we're gonna have this manager interview everybody for this position. We're gonna have this HR manager interview everybody for this position. And just being consistent within that. And not having 10 different interviews, right? I think 3 is probably pushing it, right? Yeah. You might wanna do 3, but that should be your extent. You wanna maybe do a phone interview, do a face-to-face, and then, you know, maybe that last one with some senior leadership. But again, we talked about earlier, everybody wants to be involved and we have to draw a line somewhere because we might lose that candidate. And keep in mind, we're asking them to sacrifice time off of work, right, to come and interview with us. And maybe that's an opportunity for us to be accommodating to them too. Well, do you want to meet in the morning for coffee, right? What does that look like? Still have your interview notes and document it, but maybe we can be a little bit flexible on our end as well. And then, you know, basically tying your interview questions to the competencies, and we'll talk about that. Having their resume or application in front of you, having a structured interview, not just sitting down and being like, so, not really sure what we're gonna talk about, right? Having confidence as the interviewer too makes a big deal. Documenting interview notes, document them. Dude, please do not document your opinions, like really liked her necklace, or things like, I think she'd be terrible at public speaking. We really wanna document actual facts of what they said, and not things that could be leading to discriminatory things in case your interview notes are ever looked at if you're under an audit.
Can I say one thing?
Absolutely.
And a lot of times, I think candidates tell us things that we don't really want to know, right? They tell us about their kids or what they do on Sundays or political beliefs. I think that you can write DNA, that's what I always put, did not ask, told me about kids. And then I didn't like write their names and ages or anything like that. But did not ask this question, but it came up. And that, I always found by just protecting myself like that, I felt a little bit more confident in my documentation in case something ever came up. Nothing ever did, but I liked having that documented.
Yep. And you can say redirect. You have to redirect. It's kind of awkward because someone's really excited and they're telling you about something and you're like, hey, really appreciate you sharing that information with me, but I just want to make sure that you're qualified for the position at hand, or we keep it strictly about the job that we're talking about. You might get some serial interviewers that are going against, you know, what else could I get other employers in trouble for? No, I'm just kidding. There's a lot of great people out there. We're just trying to protect you from the few cases that there are. And then probing. It's important to probe. So we're going to talk about different types of interview questions. So, you know, I've seen a lot of interviews like this. Do you have sales and marketing experience? Yep. Good. Check the box. Do you feel like your sales and marketing skills are strong, right? And they might say, yep, I'm super strong, X, Y, Z. And then you're like, okay, good. But when we actually ask different types of questions, we get better information. And I'm not making fun of anybody for using these. There is definitely a time for asking traditional questions. But it's really important that we ask additional questions beyond these. And there are times, like, are you licensed? Do you hold a current, you know, license for insurance or healthcare, whatever it is? There are times where yes or no questions are important and good. But hypothetical questions. So that's another type of interview question. I'm going to read this to you guys. Let's imagine that as a help desk analyst, you are on a call with an employee who has been called the help desk because they cannot reset their password. We've all been there. The employee starts talking about how his experience working with the help desk has always been unsatisfactory. How would you respond to this employee? All right, that's kind of good. What would you do, right? In that situation, we want to know how you would handle that. And so the employee can chat with us. But the problem is here, they can make it up and not actually do it, right? So it's easy to say, oh, I would totally do this. A lot of times we know right from wrong, but we don't always do it. So these questions allow for applicants to just say, yeah, in an ideal world, this is what I would do. Where behavioral-based questions are really the best. So give me an example of a time when you had to arrive at a compromise in order to move a project or assignment forward. Tell me about a time when you identified a new or different approach in addressing a problem or task. So that's important because, right, we're actually asking, what did you do in the past? Right, tell me a story about what you've done and how you've been successful because past behavior is a predictor of future success, right? So we know that if you've been successful and you've done this before, you're more likely to do that in the future. You can't lie about behavioral type questions, right? Or it's super hard and you can kind of catch the candidate in it, right? It's hard to lie about that. Hypothetical, we could say, yeah, sure, why not? Traditional, yep. You didn't ask me to which degree. I know sales and marketing, right? Does that make sense? Okay. And so past behavior is the best example of future performance. And a lot of times these questions start with, tell me about a time or describe a situation. Tell me exactly how you dealt with that. I encourage you guys all to go back and look at your interview questions. If you don't have interview questions for your managers, help them out, give them a few samples. And make sure that they start with these, tell me about or describe a. And then probing. This is the most important thing. Once we ask those questions, we want to make sure that we get more information. So when they answer it, we don't want to just say, okay, yep, write that down. We want to make sure that we're actually seeking the information that we want. So if they didn't ask it directly, asking probing questions to get additional information or clarify things. We don't want to jump to conclusions in those interviews. We want to make sure that we're getting the best information possible by asking those probing questions. So the art of asking interview questions, it's really an art, right? So it's not just sitting down having that conversation, but it really takes a lot of good practice to get good at it. And that's asking those open versus closed questions. So we want to ask those behavioral or those hypothetical questions versus those closed-ended questions like the traditional interviews. Actively listening. In an interview, you should not do very much talking. Has anybody ever been in an interview where someone just talks and you're like, that was easy? Because a lot of us like the sound of our own voice, right? And so you're like, wow, nailed that one. I said 5 things and they smiled the whole time. Yeah, and as an interviewer, we want to get to know the candidate. There's definitely our opportunity to share our story and share the success because we want to get them to bite and be excited and continue in that process. But really that interview is for us to learn them. I would say 80-20. You talk 80% of the time. They talk 80% of the time. You talk 20% of the time as the interviewer. And you know, the reason that is because we've already done our job to get them in here and sit down with us. And so we've done our marketing, we've done our, you know, propaganda and all that. So yep. We really want to give them that opportunity.
Yep, during the phone interview stage, I always would set the stage for the candidate. Here's what you can expect. We've got 30 minutes of time blocked off. I'm going to ask you some questions. And then I always started the conversation with telling them more about the company and the role. And then after that, it was all them talking and me just asking questions.
Yep, absolutely. And you know, it's asking those competency-based questions, so actual behavior questions based on the job competencies themselves. And then it's about technical questions, you know, to see, can you actually do the job? Kind of like they asked, I don't know what being in a blender had to do with working at Google. But, you know, technical questions like that, like maybe how would you fix this? Or if you were more in a science organization, asking them science questions. And it's really important for us to remember legal versus non-legal questions. And so is it job related? And that's what we want you to ask yourself throughout the whole time that you're asking questions. Is what I'm asking right now job related? And if not, maybe we shouldn't be asking it. So focus on the KPIs. Does anybody know what your goals are as an organization or what your key performance indicators are? I'm assuming you all do. But if you don't, I would sit down with your leadership team and say, what are our KPIs? Because as an HR person or as a manager, you're evaluated based on how good your hiring decisions are, right? Or your quick turnaround time. And an important thing to know is what are your KPIs? So if you're our clients, a lot of times we'll ask you, what are your key business objectives? And the reason is because we want to tailor a message to you guys and make sure that we're helping you meet that. Same should be done with recruiting. What are our KPIs? What are our core values? What's our mission? What are the goals that we want to accomplish in the next year? And then we hire accordingly. Our interview questions should also be based off of those. And what is your guys' most, sorry, my hair is kind of going on the microphone. What is your guys' most favorite question? Someone shout out their favorite question to ask.
Why should we hire you?
Why should we hire you? I like that one. Yeah. If you don't know why we should hire you, we probably shouldn't put you in a sales role. Right? Yeah. Yeah.
I ask people to look back at the last 6 months to a year of their life and what did they learn about themselves.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Anything else? Okay. Well, we want to do a little bit of an activity. So you'll notice that you have these little pinwheels in front of you.
Does so everybody have one? Anybody need one?
Okay. Do you have one?
All right, just enough.
All right. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna play a little activity with you guys. So we always think that interviewing can be a whirlwind, right? We don't know what we're walking into. We don't know if the questions that we ask are gonna get us in trouble. And so we have these little yellow pinwheels instead of a red flag. So what we wanna do is we're gonna ask you guys questions. And if you think this question could maybe be uncomfortable or lead us to get into some trouble, then we want you guys to raise your pinwheel. And you're not gonna get in trouble if you got it wrong. No one's judging you, it's a safe place. what year did you graduate from high school? Why is that a yellow pinwheel? Because we're trying to pinpoint age, right? This one we see a lot. This is actually something that's happened to Jen and I in our careers, and we laugh about it that it happened to both of us because we have very similar life stories. But so my first boss, when I was a recruiting intern, he said, you know, one time I went up to this guy, we both went to the U of M Duluth, and he said that he went there, and I was like, oh my gosh, what year did you graduate? And the candidate was like, you can't ask me that, right? And he was like, oh gosh, I wasn't trying to get at that. I promise, I just wanted to see if we were there at the same time. And so that happens a lot, especially if we're talking to people in the same area. Oh, you went there? Gosh, my kids graduated from there. What year did you graduate, right? And so it happens, right? Our intent isn't always to ask questions that could get us into some hot water, but it happens. Are you authorized to work in the U.S.? We can ask that, right? We just don't want to ask, are you a legal citizen? We want to say, are you authorized to work in the U.S.? Where were you born? Is it relevant to the job? No. I had a manager, he was having a really good conversation with someone, and they said, oh gosh, well, did you grow up there? Were you born there? And I kicked him. And he was like, why? And I was like, is that relevant to the job? And he was like, no, but we had a really good conversation. And I was like, I appreciate that you care and you're compassionate. And it was a great conversation, I thought so too, and I don't think the candidate thought anything of it. But again, it can lead there. What information are you attaining from asking that question? Are you over 18 years old? We can totally ask that, right? We wanna make sure that they're qualified to do the job. However, if you're hiring someone who is, you know, 16 and they can do the job, do you need to ask that, really, you know? And you might want to ask everybody that too. You might want to just say, well, you look like you might not be. You might want to put that on your application instead of asking it in the interview. Especially because if you ask in an interview, they might say, yeah, actually I'm 30, right? So you might just want to put that on the application. This job requires frequent overnight travel. Would you be able to meet those requirements? Totally cool, right? You can ask that. We just don't want to say, gosh, she mentioned you had kids and then all of a sudden ask that question, right? So we want to be cognizant of that. Is there any health-related reason that you are not able to perform the job which you're applying? Caution, right? We would say, are you able to meet the job requirements with or without reasonable accommodation? At this point, we don't want to know what that is. Tell me something that's true that almost no one agrees with you on. It's a weird question, right? And I actually pulled that from famous CEOs who asked, I can't remember which one asked that question, but top companies, I pulled that question. I thought, you know, what if that goes into a religious issue, right? What if I'm asking something and I might find out that this person's crazy and I don't want to hire them, so it might be a good question, but where could that lead to? And so that one might not be the best question, right? And as a candidate, I'd be like, I don't know, right? So are we also asking questions that make candidates feel uncomfortable? To the point where they're like, what was that? What motivates you to get out of bed each morning? I would rephrase that to what makes you want to come to work and do your best every day? What makes you successful or what makes you motivated? Because most people are gonna say my family, right? Like my kids. So that could be giving us information that we don't necessarily want. So again, a lot of times it's fine tuning our questions. What have you done in the last 6 months job related that could really be beneficial or that we should know about you? What is your most proud accomplishment job really, you know, in regards to your job or education? Did you grow up in the area? Right. No, I actually grew up in Italy, right? I didn't. That would have been a cool story though. Why did you let your license lapse? Depends what kind of license we're talking about, right? So if we're talking about driver's license, that could be something that maybe could lead us to a protected characteristic just because of trends. But it's like maybe you have to have your CNA license. Why did you let that lapse? Maybe that might give you some good information, but it might also be like, well, you know, I had a sick family member, I had to take care of them, and so on and so on. If you could be any type of pizza topping, what would you be? The answer is the cheese, because that holds everything together, okay? Just so you guys, if you ever get asked that question. But yeah, I mean, is that job related? No, because maybe if you work at a pizza place, you could say that, but still, I'm just not really seeing how it's connected. What's your biggest strength? Your biggest weakness? That's okay, right? I don't love that question, because I think it's like overdone, right? We all expect that, so everybody has an answer. But again, not going to get us into too much trouble. What didn't you get a chance to include on your resume that you would like us to know? I like that question. I think that's a good one to ask. What else should we know about you that you didn't have an opportunity to share about your work experience? Because I think sometimes we ask questions and the candidates don't always have an opportunity to share some things that could be helpful for us. What's your superpower or spirit animal? Yeah. I mean, we could find out some crazy things about people. But that's a legitimate question that one of the top companies uses. And I personally don't think it has anything to do with the job. Tell me about yourself. Good, right? Tell me about yourself. I think we could tighten up and tell me a little bit about your work experience. Walk me through your resume. Could be better. Because when people tell me about myself, well, I am, you know, brown hair, hazel eyes, and, no, it's not a dating profile. But, you know, sometimes people answer that question where they say, you know, I'm married, I have two kids, yada, yada, yada. So we can tighten up our questions a lot. What would you do in the case or when the zombie apocalypse happens? Legitimate, someone asked that question. One of the big, yeah. What does that have to do? I mean, maybe if you're a safety person and you are an emergency preparedness person, what are you ready? Do you have every case thinking of? But I also don't really think that one's applicable. Tell me about your failures. Again, we can probably tighten that one up a little bit to talk about work-related, but definitely okay. So how's everybody doing? Should we take a quick break?
Well, we're going to start back up with employment law. Allie gets to cover all the fun parts, and then I get stuck talking about discrimination and employment law.
We flipped a coin.
Yeah.
It was fair.
Right. So when you're interviewing, and those slides that we went through with the red flags or our whirlwinds, we want to stop and we don't want to forget about our employment law. Like Allie said, we want to tighten up those interview questions and make sure that we're asking legitimate questions that are based on the job.
And so I just want to make one misperception out there is that if you ask those, you're automatically going to get sued, right? That's not true. It's not illegal to necessarily ask those questions, but what is illegal is to make employment decisions based on those questions. So what happens a lot of times, we get in trouble as employers because we ask questions, we get that information, and then we don't hire that person or we make a determination and our interview notes aren't good enough, so we can't justify why we hired this person over this person. And because those questions or that information came up, it looks discriminatory. So again, that's why you just want to be cognizant of the questions that you're asking and the information that you're obtaining and writing down.
Yep. So we don't want to forget about employment law. Interviewing, it's not just the questions like we talked about. It's also our job postings. It's everything that's happening in that recruitment cycle, our application and our hiring. Like Allie said, maybe we want to put on our application a checkbox. Are you 18 years old? If it applies to the position. To your organization. Background checks. How many people do background checks? Great. Do you have a vendor that does them for you?
Good. Or are you Googling people?
Please don't Google people.
Please don't Google people.
A great question to make sure your vendor is compliant with Fair Credit Reporting Act.
Are you giving out the Fair Credit Reporting Act document?
Or do they on their website or when they email a candidate?
If you don't know, please write that down. Because that's an important thing you want to give all the applicants.
Yep. Yep. Job referrals. Job assignments and promotions are the way we're promoting people. Is it fair? Pay and benefits. Again, is that fair? Reasonable accommodations or religious accommodations. Are we making those accommodations? They don't always have to be asked for either. Terms and conditions of employment. We want to make sure that our terms of employment aren't discriminatory and that we're also not stumbling into a sexual harassment, a quid pro quo, like a this for that type scenario. You do this for me, I'll promote you.
And I just want to make one quick comment about job referrals. So a lot of times, how many of you guys have internal referral programs where someone gets a bonus, right? Those are great. Don't get rid of those. That's not what I'm saying. But if we have a problem of discrimination or everybody's the same in our organization, you can tell that they came off a conveyor belt and we're all the same. We think the same. We look the same. We act the same. That could be a problem. Because then what are you guys doing to encourage diversity within your workforce? So did you have a question?
I know it's kind of come to our America. Certain religion that requires the human to pray in times of
day. Yep. Yep.
How do you guys handle the accommodating that versus your job duties don't allow for that?
Yep. Good question. And it's a fine line, right? And so what we have to do as employers is a lot of times we might engage with the legal contract. We might ask a consultant who's been working in it. We'll talk about accommodation coming up in a little bit once we get to FMLA. But it's really, is it really an unreasonable accommodation? There's a lot of factors that go into it. Yep. And I'm going to say most of the time it's probably not that unreasonable of an accommodation that the employee is asking for. If you have three people that work for you and it's one of those three people, that might be a situation where you're like, hey, we just can't meet the business needs then. But if you are like a Walmart and you can't make an accommodation, they're probably going to call BS, right?
Yep. Yep. Is it an undue burden on your organization would be something that could be taken into consideration. But we just also want to make sure every situation like this, unfortunately, in HR, our tagline is,
it depends.
Like, we can't answer that question for you because it depends on the situation. It depends on what you've done in the past. Depends on your policies. So we have to really dig in deep to get an answer for you. So the religious accommodation kind of depends on your organization.
So afterward, we can talk about your organization. We'll ask you a lot of questions to get through that to help you figure out, is it an accommodation process? Is it something that we can do? Because it does. We have to take it into consideration. And I think the biggest thing as of employers, it's hard, and I have a slide on this. It's hard because we have compliance, and then we have promoting goodwill of our employees, right? We want to be an employer where people can come to work. We want to be accommodating. But then we also have this obligation under the law. But we can go above and beyond that obligation, right? We can still say, you know what, we'll accommodate people. If that's what you need, you can do it. Maybe you can work different shifts. Maybe you can, you know, have someone cover for you for that time. Maybe we can move you into a different role. What does that look like?
Mm-hmm. So as a rule of thumb, we just don't want to ask questions around age, children, childcare, marital status, political views, race, religion, medical, and disability. What you can ask, what experience did you gain in the service industry that would be relevant to you doing a good job? Are you over the age of 18? Can you accomplish the duties listed on the job description or posting with or without reasonable accommodation? Can you work overtime with little notice? Can you work evenings and weekends?
So that could be a good question too, if you're wondering about if the job requires evening and weekends, right? If a lot of times Target is hiring just for evenings and weekend shifts. And so that can be a good question to ask if you're asking everybody. You're not just asking people that look a certain way. You want to ask that question consistently.
Yep. And the do's and don'ts of interviewing. We kind of went through some of this already, and I'm glad I get to do something fun. Mm-hmm. Please walk me through your resume. What kinds of tasks did you accomplish? What was an average day like for you? What did you like the best? What did you like the least? Give me an example of a time you had to deal with a difficult coworker, and how did you handle that situation? How would you describe your current workload? Is this a pace you're comfortable with? What would your current or last boss say about how you collaborate with others? Is your current position team-based or more individual? Can you please explain this in more detail?
So that's the probing that we talked about. Explain that in more detail.
And tell me about a time, remember we talked about that, you had trouble with trouble working with a difficult or demanding customer. We've all had to deal with that. How did you handle it? What was the outcome? What do you like about being in customer service? What do you find is the most difficult thing about being in customer service? Tell me about a time when you were part of a great team. What was your part in making the team effective? Describe a time when you kept from getting bored dealing with routine tasks. I like that one. Could you share a recent accomplishment with us, something that you're proud of? And tell me about the quality of your, tell me how the quality of your work impacts others around you, and give me an example. So I think these are some really great examples of questions that dig a little deeper. So do I have to ask everybody the same questions? What do you guys think? For the same role? Yep.
You want to ask the same basic questions, yep. But again, those probing questions can totally be different.
Yep, they might take you down a different path, but I would recommend having an interview guide, having your set of questions for each role that you're interviewing for, and stick to those basic questions. If I know right away that this candidate is not for me, do I have to continue with the interview? Yep. Now, if the candidate says, I'm done, you know, this isn't for me, you don't have to like tie him down or sit on him to get him to stay, and I have to finish the interview. They can opt out, but we should really continue the interview and finish the interview.
Real life story, had a candidate with me and we did a phone interview, sounded great, everything was fine. Had me, had our CEO and our owner sitting down at the table. She's going through the interview, halfway through, she goes, yeah, you know, I actually never actually wanted the position, I just really wanted to see your office. And I was like, so what do we do now? Like, you know, but that's the thing. In those situations, you guys are all shocked, yeah. The things that happen in our life, right? Yeah, things like that don't even faze me anymore, unfortunately. But, you know, I think the thing is, those kind of situations, you don't have to be like, well, we didn't ask you all the questions. Or if you could take these home and send them back, you don't have to do that, right? If the candidate says, you know, I don't think this is a good fit, you want to ask a majority of the questions. And the reason behind that is because you don't want them to come and ask them one question and then maybe it's like, well, you saw me and now it's, you know, discriminatory or whatever it is. So you want to go through the whole process and you might find out things about the candidate. Like you might meet someone immediately and be like, meh. But then you might talk to them and you might be like, yeah, you're a great fit. I had my first impression bias.
Yep. All right. What do I do if the candidate tells me something inappropriate or personal? I shared with you what I do. What do you guys do? Redirect? Let's not go down that scary path. Let's talk about the job-related functions. Yep. How long should an interview last? Probably depends on the position, right? Each position might be a little different. Typically a phone interview, I would say, depending again on the position, 20 to 30 minutes, maybe sometimes upwards of 45. Kind of just depends. Some candidates talk in paragraphs and sentences, so how do I regain control? When they take a breath, I quick insert myself and quick throw in a question or start talking, because they'll eventually take a quick breath.
Or could you maybe just do a gentle hand and be like, that's really good what you said. I want to ask you a question following up on that.
Yep. And what will I do if a candidate won't talk to me? What if they just sit there and stare at me? How weird, right? Or just answer my questions with yes or no answers? Keep trying, keep building, but sometimes candidates won't share with you much more than yes or no answers. Yes. Yep.
Absolutely.
Yep. Exactly.
Great point. Oh, absolutely. Yep. First thing you do when you shake their hand, smile, you know, always smiling at them. I think that's a big thing, you know, just smiling, nodding when they're talking to you. I think that's important, creating that culture where they want to be. Otherwise, if they feel super uncomfortable, they might say, that was so awkward, I don't ever want to walk back in that building again. But then, you know, when they walk in your office, you shake your hand and say, gosh, how was your drive? Did you find our place okay? You know, this weather's beautiful. I mean, it's small talk, right? That's okay. It makes people feel loose and comfortable.
Yep. And we all know, as recruiters and HR people and hiring managers, people are just going to be uncomfortable. We get that, right? So we'll give them a little bit of grace with that. So best practices, we want to think outside the box. What can we do different creatively? How can we tell our story? How can we sell ourselves to the candidates? I can't emphasize it enough. Be prepared. Don't look at the resume as a candidate is waiting in the lobby. Let's make sure we're looking at it ahead of time and thinking of good things that we want to talk to them about. Allie said it before, but talk less and listen more. The candidate should talk about 80% of the time. We want to set the stage. We want to make them comfortable. Tell them what the expectations are of the interview, how long this is going to last, and then let them take over and do the talking. For the most part, we just want to ask job-related questions. You know, we want to avoid the what pizza topping or what animal would you be if you were an animal, unless you're working at Papa Murphy's. Probe to draw out information, but do that carefully. Take legally and defensible notes. I always tell hiring managers, and it's worst case scenario, but imagine on the screen are your notes. What if that was the case? You want to make sure your notes don't have your opinions. Like Allie said, we want it to be factual. We want everything that we document to be clear and concise. Follow up and promote a good relationship. How oftentimes do you hear candidates say, well, I applied, but I never heard back? Right? We hear that, and we're all spread really thin, but we do want to follow up with candidates. We always want to promote that goodwill. We want a good community reputation. And by always following up with candidates and giving them following up with them, letting them know where they're at in the process is promoting our goodwill.
Especially if you really want this candidate, and you have to wait and wait for other people to get in on that interview with them. Say, hey, just want you to know we're still thinking about you. We're making this decision. We have this going on within the organization, so they're staying interested. Yeah?
What about candidates that apply that you do not want to interview?
Good question.
What about the question is, what about candidates that apply that you don't want to interview?
Like, in the interest of maintaining that good reputation, is that something that you recommend to reach out and say, hey, no thanks?
You know, if it's a serial applicant, we've all had those people that keep applying and keep applying and keep applying, and you see their LinkedIn profile all the time. I have sent emails before, you know, just nice, you know, thanks, but no thanks, an email of regret or a phone call.
Mm-hmm. I'm half and half on it. I think sometimes if they're just applying everywhere, they're not going to notice if you didn't follow up. They're not going to know that they applied to your company, especially in a job market where everybody's looking for a job. Now I think it's a little bit harder for people to find a role. so I'm half and half because I think that there is some message to it, like, hey, we don't want to interview you. You're out of the process. Then you're not going to get that person calling you all the time. I think if you have an applicant tracking system, do it. Mm-hmm. If you're going to do it manually, don't waste your time. Anybody else have any other opinions? Feel free to share. Yeah?
I have a question. A lot of times we're trying to determine a culture fit for an applicant.
Yeah.
Where we would ask some of those more unorthodox questions that might not directly relate to the position, but we're trying to get a feel for what motivates the person and how
yep.
they work inside of our organization.
Yeah.
What's the best way for us to ask those questions and get that information while also protecting ourselves from unintended discrimination?
Yeah, great question. Mm-hmm. Do you have an example? Do you know one of the questions off the top of your head?
For instance, if I asked maybe like, what are your goals?
Yeah. And you could say, what are your professional goals?
Mm-hmm. Or your work-related goals.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it could be, so personally, I want to finish my master's. I'm going through that. That could be a goal that ties back to professional. Because personal goals, you don't know where they're going to take that, right? So if you could say, what are some of your professional goals? You can see, are they a motivated individual, right? If they're like, I haven't really thought about it. But if they're like, I want to do this and this, I want to be here, you're going to get a lot more information from that candidate. So I think just adding that one word will really help you tighten that up.
Okay.
Is that helpful?
Sure.
Okay, good. Did you have a question over there, or a statement? Yeah.
I did, piggybacking off of the first question.
Yeah.
Are there any people that are applying that you do not want to interview?
Yeah.
When that comes to an internal candidate that the manager is not interested in?
Good question.
What are your tips on that?
Yes, absolutely. That's an awkward conversation, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I would say, what's your process? Does the manager automatically interview everybody? So why isn't the manager interested? Is it the manager from, like, they already are that person's manager? Or is it that it's a manager in a different department? And I would say that's going to be the most important way to keep that employee engaged. So if we have a candidate, so the question was, what do we do if we have a candidate who is an internal candidate and they apply and the manager's not interested in moving forward? It's still about promoting goodwill. So it's having a conversation with the manager, understanding why, and then figuring out how can we help that candidate get where they want to be. So I had this happen, and I sat down with the employee and I said, here are the three things that we need to help you do to get more involved in the organization so that you can move into that role, right? And so then you're helping that employee and you're having a real conversation, right? You need to be honest. Hey, you haven't done anything to show us that you're motivated. Your performance review the last 3 years has been stagnant. What are you doing to grow and develop or show us that you're ready for that next level? So having an honest conversation, but then not just leaving it there, like, you don't do this. How can we help you? What is it that we can help you do to get there?
Yep, I did the exact same thing. I had an internal serial applicant and sat down and had a very real conversation about, here's, you want to grow, here's the things that you should, that you could focus on doing. Mm-hmm. And then they can take the initiative or not.
Yeah. And I think, you know, that actually brought up a good point. I like when organizations do, like, get to know other departments so we can have people know what other career opportunities are within our company, especially if we have really good talent. Maybe they hit the ceiling within our department. Can we let them get to know other managers and other departments so that they can grow and develop so we don't lose that top talent, but they really have an opportunity, not only just to see what's out there for them, but also understand what we do as an organization as a whole.
Yep.
Great question. Thank you.
And so the bottom line, you don't want to always hire the best candidate. You want to hire the candidate who is best for the job.
So we get a lot of times people are like, this person's great. We should throw all this money at them,
yep,
right? Because they're going to be awesome. But again, are they going to be awesome for this job? And then also maybe are they going to be awesome for that next job, right? So how do we know if we have that pipeline too?
Yep.
So onboarding and orientation, right? This is our big moment to shine. We've gone through all of the work to hire and to recruit and then select that person. We've made the offer. They've accepted it. We feel a sigh of relief. But then we have to show up. Because usually when we hire people, it's because we're short staff, right? And so we're like, we need someone now. I don't know about you, but most organizations don't hire super ahead of time and then let people sit around and twiddle their thumbs. So when we have someone come on board, we need them. But throwing them to the wolves isn't going to do anybody any good. So orientation is an event, right? It's us introducing them to the company. That's usually your first day. You're coming in, you're talking to HR. HR is going through the paperwork. And onboarding is really a process. And that's what we want you guys to take away from this is it's integrating new hires through that process. Onboarding can take up to a year, maybe a little bit more, depending on what your job is and how cyclical your business is. If you guys have things that happen every month, it might take a couple months. If you have year-long processes, it might take that long. So orientation, be prepared. And so what we do in our organization is we actually send some additional information. Hey, welcome aboard. Here's what to expect on your first day, right? Because that first day is so nerve-wracking. No one sleeps the night before. Here's what you should wear. Here's where you should park. Bring a lunch or, hey, we're going to take you out to lunch. Don't worry about that. You'll have a fridge. have a phone or computer set up, right? So have a really good process with your IT department so that they know having a computer, an email address, all that stuff set up. Not just walking over to IT and being like, hey, this person just started. Can you get them a computer? Unless your IT department can turn it around in 3 seconds. The manager should be there on the first day. I know that that seems really obvious, but not always possible, right? Especially the manager automatically goes to another location or takes vacation. It's really important for your manager to be there for the first day. And then gives them something to accomplish. Have them do a project or a task where they can feel like they've contributed. It doesn't have to be something big. But give them at least something so they're like, yeah, I know what I'm doing. I feel a little bit comfortable. I've already had one accomplishment. And then orientation, you obviously have to go through the I-9s. If you're not getting that information filled out on day one, you should be, right? Because candidates need to fill out section one on their first day or before it and after an offer. You're going to go through benefits, most likely. Even if you have a 60-day waiting period, I suggest you give them some information on benefits. Give them a tour of the office, right? Kind of nice to know where we work. And then tell them you know, what's in the area, what's around you. Here's pens, here's paper. Here's some things that you should know. The bathroom door kind of sticks. If you stand in front of it, you might not get knocked out. Things like that, you want to let them know. These are real life situations we've had. So things that you want to know, right? Like, what do you wish someone would have told you? And maybe a good idea is to ask employees who've recently started in the last 6 months, what do you wish we would have told you when you started? And then use that to create and develop something. Yeah.
So we sent out a survey after like the first week.
Yeah.
Kind of asking about the recruiting process and how the first
great.
And something that keeps coming up with employees is that they said they had wanted more specific information about benefits before
yeah.
starting. So what's your advice on what we should really tell them, like in the offer letter?
That's great, right? So if you have MMA as your broker, you might have a benefit guide. And those benefit guides can be something you can give them. That could be something. Of course, you want to just keep some of that stuff private, but it's all going to get out there anyway. So you can give them that benefit guide. I like to know that because that's a big part of our compensation package. So if we're showing that from day one, hey, here's your great benefit package. With the offer letter, we're already making that message clear, right? That's a part of your compensation. See this benefit information. So yeah, totally feel free. I usually send it to people maybe when they're debating taking the offer. Or we're in that finalist part of the conversations.
And I've had jobs where when I'm confirming like an in-person interview, if I've already done a phone screen and determined that this person's a good person to bring in, I'll send, you know, attach directions to the office, attach a quick one-pager on benefits just so they can get a high-level overview of what we offer, and then at the offer stage, giving them more in-depth information. Mm-hmm. I think candidates like to know that as well because that's a big part of if they're going to change jobs, what kind of benefits do you offer? What makes your company attractive?
Yep. And I like that too. So what I do, because we are on the third floor of our building, so you have to take an elevator or walk up the stairs to get to our office. I always send an email, hey, our address is here. You can park here. The building looks like this. You can come up to the third floor, ask receptionist for us. It's accessible either by stairs or elevator, right? So then you don't have to ask someone who maybe needs that accommodation to ask that. You're already opening it up. So kind of a side note, but something to maybe think about. But great question. Yeah, are you promoting those benefits? And if you guys aren't doing those new hire surveys, feel free. I mean, you can do a little piece of paper. You could do a SurveyMonkey. It's a great opportunity to say, what else did we miss? And improve your processes. Mm-hmm. First impressions are important, right? So we have an opportunity from when they come in the building to look like we have our stuff together. Even if we don't, we want to fake it till we make it, right? We might be like, thank God you're here. We just need you to take this and run with it. But it's really our opportunity to shine because engagement has already begun, right? We're already in that process. We don't want people to have buyer's remorse, right? Like, what did I just do? What did I sign up for? Recognize people. There's this book called How Full Is Your Bucket? And in there, they actually encourage managers to say, what name is it that you like to be called by? Because sometimes it's awkward. So we have an intern, and we assume that she went by Isabella. And then all of a sudden on our first day, she's like, I actually go by Belle. And we're like, oh, no, we already know you as Isabella, right? So that could have been something. We could have been like, hey, do you want to go by, do you prefer to go by Isabella? Recognition, how do you like to be recognized? I've had a manager ask me that before, and I'm like, yeah, that's awesome. Thanks for caring about me as an individual. So how do you like to be recognized? Is it through gift cards? Is it through going out to lunch? Is it about, you know, thank you notes? Do you like private recognition? Do you like public recognition? What does that look about? What does that look like to you? What are your hobbies, right? We can ask them, what do you like to do for fun? What's important to you? And then we can tie those back. That's important for us as a manager to know these things so we can relate to the employees. Hot buttons, what are your biggest pet peeves? I hate when people do X, Y, Z, or I hate when people don't just tell me things straight up and, you know, you hear through the grapevine. What do you expect from me as a manager? What can I do to help you? Love that question. If you're not asking your employees it, I encourage you to ask that. What are your expectations of me? We're really good at telling employees what our expectations are of them, what that we expect of them, but we don't always ask, what do you expect of me? How can I help support you? Review that job description on the first day, right? We have it for a reason. I'm sure you didn't just fill it out for fun or because HR made you. So use it, right? Show the employees that. And I like the job description because it's kind of a cop-out for us, right? We can be like, we don't have to be the bad guy, but we can be like, on your job description, this is an essential function of your job, right? And then, you know, what else? What else do you guys do on that first day that's really important? Anybody have any success stories to share or things that you guys really like?
Well,
We take people out to lunch on their first day, get to know your team. Then you don't have to worry about bringing a lunch, what's appropriate, should I not heat up fish in the microwave, right? So we bring out people to lunch. It's really nice. We also have an orientation schedule that we created. So you know what to expect during your first 3 weeks, what's going to happen, what your schedule is going to look like. That might change a little bit. But then we also tell everybody internally who they're going to meet with. We have a meet with different departments, so you understand who we are as an organization. Once a quarter, we have a CEO meeting where our CEO sits down with new hires, talks about the philosophy of our company, talks about why we exist, how you can succeed. We have clarity meetings. We have committees. So we have all these things, and we let people know about them. And we let people know those important things. Jen's going to talk about mentoring programs, which is exciting, and that's a great opportunity to do that as well. So onboarding, it's really important because, again, that's introducing people to the organization. And you experience less turnover if you have a good onboarding process. And so that might be the mentoring program. It might be the information that you tell new hires. Whatever it is, it's important that you do it well because it's going to help you reduce your turnover. So four ways to start off an employee right. You know, thoroughly describe how their role creates business value. Show them how important their role is. Tell them what your business is, what's important, what's your passion, what's your purpose. Map out who their customers are, right? It's important to know who our customers are, even if they're internal or external. And then set the expectations, set goals, and start giving feedback right away. And then explain why you hired them. Hey, I hired you because I think you're going to be a great asset to this team. I really liked that you had this background, mm-hmm. right? Because they might be in that feeling like, God, I don't know if I'm ready for this, right? What am I doing? What did I sign myself up for?
Yep, my most recent manager told me why he hired me during my first week, and I was like, nobody's ever done that before. That's fascinating.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm going to skip the activity.
Okay.
We're going to skip the activity just for time's sake, so I apologize if you guys want to know what it is. I can tell you after.
All right, so onboarding, mentoring programs. Who has mentoring programs? Okay, so maybe we've got those hungry millennials in our organizations that are excited for stretch assignments and they want to grow within the organization. This might be a great project and task for them to take on. So what does mentoring really do? We want to schedule meetings with mentors and mentees. It doesn't have to be somebody in their specific department. Oftentimes, I think it's best if it's somebody who's not in their department because they can be kind of their first real friend outside of their department within the organization. They can show you the how-tos, how to work the copy machine if you still have a fax machine, if the bathroom door appears to has a knob on it but doesn't really turn, it pushes open. True story, that happened to me on my first day at one of my jobs. Didn't know how to open the bathroom door. Take them to lunch, get to know them. If you're in a downtown area, teach them the skyways. Teach them the walking paths, what's around to go to lunch. All of those things that kind of make it a little bit more comfortable at work. And it's nice to have that first friend outside of your department. So in a world where it's sometimes easier to just do it myself, I'm guilty of this at work and at home, it's difficult to step back and give somebody the time and give them the opportunity to grow, but it really is critical. It's really critical to our success. And even though mentoring isn't easy, it is a program. It's not something that you're going to build and put on a shelf. It's a living thing that you have to keep current and somebody has to own, hence maybe a hungry millennial that wants a stretch assignment. And we need to do this because 80% of employees say, I want to be mentored at work. I want this at my place of employment. So it's something that we can do to keep employees happy. It also helps us discover who our employees are. They're like an iceberg, right? We can see some things on the surface, but what's underneath is a ton of stuff that we don't know, right? And all of our teams are diverse. They're like pieces of the puzzle. Everybody has different experiences, a different culture, baggage, age. They bring all this stuff to work, and then we're supposed to work together with this iceberg and our puzzle. And then we get the generations, and we're lucky enough to have four generations in our work right now. We've got the traditionalists, our baby boomers, our Gen Xers, and our millennials. And the great thing is they all want to work differently, and they all communicate differently. So between our iceberg and our puzzle and our millennials, we've got a lot of individual differences going on in our workplace. Yeah, you can go ahead. All generations want, though. Everybody wants an enjoyable job. Everybody wants fulfillment and purpose. Good pay and good benefits. I'll take that, sure. Yeah, that's great. Perspective on what's important. To be respected. To have a company that's stable. When I used to do interviewing, that was one of the top questions. How stable is the company, right? I bet you guys get asked that a lot during interviews. Contributions. Things that you're doing are being acknowledged. Yeah, it's great to be recognized at work and validated and appreciated. So we have to work with all these different kinds of generations. We've got our puzzle pieces and we've got our iceberg. So what are our managers gonna do? Well, they might have to shift their styles because not every way that they manage is gonna work for all of their employees. And that's hard for managers to do. But you might have to shift your style. And you have to start by knowing your employees, the iceberg, the pieces of the puzzle, the generation, how they like to be communicated with. And they might have to be a little bit like a chameleon, right? They might have to change their colors and adjust to each person that they manage.
I think the biggest thing, the reason I like the chameleon example is because a lot of managers forget that it's our responsibility to shift our style to our employees. It's not the other way around. So if we know an employee is a visual learner, do we shift our style to that? So my boss the other day was trying to explain something, and I was like, you know, I need a picture. And so he drew a picture for me, and I was like, that makes sense, right? I'm a visual learner. And so can we shift our style to meet that of the employees and get to know who they are? It starts with knowing who your employees are, knowing what their personality type is, knowing what their preferred communication method is, and knowing what their communication style is. And that's really where we start. And it's our job as a manager to shift our style because, again, we want to keep those employees and keep them engaged and doing the best that they can be. Yeah, do you have a question?
Yeah, is this time where you would put in, if you know you've got an employee that likes direct communication?
Yes. Absolutely. And so that might be something you can ask when they first start, you know, how is that going? How do you like your communication? Do you like me to email you? Do you like face-to-face? Do you like direct? And you'll get to know that about your employees, mm-hmm. you know, as you're working with them. But it's important to make note of that and then take action accordingly. That's a great question. I think we all need to be aware of it. And sometimes we're so busy that we forget that that's a part of our job, too, is to slow down and really make that communication. Because we get this like me bias where we just think everybody's like me, right? Yeah. They like this direct communication. It's easier to do it that way. But unfortunately, it's not that easy.
And maybe it might be, maybe your managers might want to do like a Myers-Briggs or another assessment like that to just really fully understand everybody they're working with, what their learning styles are, what their personality is. That's not a bad thing to do either.
Mm-hmm. Everybody have a company handbook? How many of you have read it? It's good, right? Yeah, it's important. That's the biggest thing. It's we have these. Do we actually read it and know what the policies are? Again, it's kind of our thing as a manager, HR, to be like, well, here's a policy, right? That's going to give us guidance on what we can do. If we have policies that we don't follow, let's take them out, right? And so it's important that we have that updated, not only so that employees know what their expectations are, but also so we have our legal compliance there as well. So as much as you might not like your handbook, it's important to know what's in it. Standalone policies that apply, managers should know that. If there are things as HR, we might need to let them know. We might need to have a centralized place so that all of our managers can have access to all of our policies. Anybody ever find out like, oh, we had a policy on that? I didn't know, sorry. Right? So are we helping have that information? Same with time attendance and reporting that. What does that look like? What are the expectations? So employee handbook, we need to know that. We also need to know job descriptions. Anybody have a job description for every single one of your positions that is updated? Get out. Give yourself a round of applause. Nice, nice. You should feel accomplished. That is hard, right? As HR people, I will tell you all day, every day that you need to have job descriptions because that's what starts out our recruitment process. That starts out the life cycle and it goes through the whole thing. But it's my least favorite thing to do. Right? Because it takes a lot of time and there's a lot of effort. And to do it effectively, really what you should be doing is analyzing the job, sitting down with the employee, talking through is this still true? What does that mean? Maybe it's observing the employee. Maybe it's doing a job analysis. It's not just throwing words on a page. And so it's a lot of work to actually do it effectively, but it really will save your butt a lot of the times when making determinations or making, you know, determinations if it's a reasonable accommodation. So what can managers do? Be an example for your employees. Am I acting how I want my employees to act? Do one-on-ones. Does anybody do one-on-ones with their employees? Yeah, those are great. You find out a lot of information, right? And you get to know who they are on that individual level and know what the work pace is going like.
And a lot of times our manager, we bring in the information. It's our time to talk to him. It's not always, you know, what he has on an agenda for us. It's more our time. Yeah, occasionally there will be things, but it's nice to have your time as well.
Yep, your time to say stuff. And share your wins. We have one manager within our organization who actually has employees fill out a sheet with their past three wins for the month. And every time they sit down with her, they talk about the past three wins. And so that's an opportunity to have the brag and show, like, gosh, we're doing a lot of great things, right? And so as a manager, a lot of times we're busy. We don't know all the great things that our employees are doing. And so sometimes we just talk a lot about the problems, right? Because, hey, I need you to help me fix this. I need you to help me fix this. And that's a great opportunity to really focus on, hey, thanks for doing that. That's great. I'm glad you accomplished that. Of course, be clear and consistent, especially when communicating expectations to people. If you think that they need to know the information, you should give it to them. It's no good holding it in and sharing it so that everybody's on the same page. And also setting the expectations that offensive behavior isn't tolerated, right? So in a lot of organizations, they say, gosh, we need team building, we need team building. And I'm like, you need a strong leader who's not going to tolerate it, right? Because we can do team building all day long, but if you don't have a strong leader who's going to help you create that behavior and stop it while it's happening, we're not going to get anywhere. Regular scheduled meetings. I'm not going to read through all these because you guys can read them, but here's some great questions to ask. How can I help support you? Wow, that's a powerful question, right? If someone says that, you're like, wow, you do care about me as an individual. You're not like, sorry, the workload's really heavy, but how can I support you? Do you feel like you have work-life integration balance? Not work-life balance, right, but work-life integration. I think work-life balance is kind of out the door now, right? We promote it, but who has it? And so it's really about that integration. Do we allow you to have a flexible work environment so that if you need to take your kids to the doctor, you can do that? If you need to go to a concert, you can do that. Or if you want to go, you can do that. Are we allowing them to work from home if possible? What does that look like? So I'm going to skip through that activity quickly, too, just because we don't have a lot of time left. But psychological contracts, I love this because really what a psychological contract is, it's an unwritten agreement or unwritten expectations between an employee and managers or an employee and companies. So anybody heard of psychological contracts? Okay, so what it is, it's the fairness or the balance about how the employee is treated by the employer and what the employee puts into the job. So you'll see up here on the image, I work, I do my job, I meet the expectations, and you pay me, right? That was the old school mentality. I grew up and my dad's like, you go to work, you get a paycheck. That's what you expect, that's what they expect, right? That's it. Well, there's all this stuff under the surface. So as an employee, if I'm committed to you, I'm loyal, I drive change, I'm innovative, I help you do all these things, I sacrifice my personal time, I give you my best, then I expect that you give me job security. You give me the training and development opportunities I know. You recognize me. You give me more qualifications, so you help me get my certifications or my degree. You give me a better benefits or pension, flexibility, ownership, quality. So there's all this unwritten expectations, and there's actually studies out there that show that if we have super engaged employees and we don't do anything to help bring them more engaged or keep them engaged, we'll lose them because we've broken that psychological contract because they feel like they're putting in more than they're getting out. So it's really important that we're aware of that as an employer. And I love this image because people don't leave their jobs, they leave their managers, right? We've all heard that. It's hard. It makes us feel bad as managers. But it's a lot of times true, right? Because maybe we're not a good personality fit or we're not doing what we can to help meet the expectations of the employee. And then we also have this awesome thing called employment law that we need to figure out how to balance, right? So we're balancing morale and engagement. And then we're saying, gosh, we can't do that because what does that look like, right? So it's a total delicate balance that we have to face.
So our manager's responsibilities, it's a long list. You have to monitor your workplace, educate your workforce, address issues if they're brought up promptly, maintain confidentiality, assist with investigations, and that's not a lot of fun, maintain those terms and conditions of employment, make sure employees know how to report things, take immediate action, handle investigations discreetly and confidently and confidentially, and you want to be sensitive to those people that are involved. So when a concern is brought forward by an employee, we want to make sure we listen. We're not jumping to a conclusion. We respond promptly, even if we don't have an answer. I'm still working on that. I'll get back to you. I haven't forgotten about you. Report and document. We want to make sure that our documentation is, again, clear and concise. Don't ignore a claim as insignificant. Don't delay in acting. You need to act immediately. You can't always promise confidentiality. I know as HR people, a lot of times we get people coming to us and saying, I just need to talk about this, but I don't want you to do anything about it. We can't always do that, right?
My favorite line is, hold on, I just need to make sure that we're on the same page. You know, it's my job in the organization to take certain actions, so there might be something that I need to follow up with afterward.
Yep.
But I would love to have a conversation with you. Is there something that I can help you with knowing that?
So other common issues we see is not reporting an incident. Maybe not determining the basic timeline or the issues. Evaluating the situation and staying objective. And again, not documenting. If you learn one thing today, you'll learn you need to document, right? We keep saying it.
If you guys are looking for a really great gift for your managers, they sell these little notebooks that you can put in your pocket. Those are a really good one. And it, you know, or post-it notes, something. Write something down, right? That's the best thing we can do.
Yep. If we're involved in an investigation, which isn't a fun thing, we might have to discipline employees. There might be things that we have to have further discussions about. It's not a lot of fun, but we're going to take action based upon what the circumstances have been, what happened. We really want to restore a positive workplace. So if we have to do an investigation and do some discipline, this is why. And retaliation. Remember, I was the one who got stuck with talking about all the federal laws. While federal law also protects you as employees, that if you participate in an investigation, you will not be retaliated against. If anyone retaliates against you, they are subject to termination, up to termination possibly. So really, as a manager, we want to make sure we promote trust and respect. We value our team members. We foster that open two-way communication. We're fair and consistent. We need to take the emotion out of it, which isn't always easy. We need to take that proactive approach.
Guys, I have to restart my computer in a little bit. Just so you guys
in
know.
9 hours.
So you had the reminder.
Take a proactive approach to employee relations. Emphasize teamwork, emphasize involvement, and always assume positive intent.
Maybe seen this picture? Right, so here we automatically assume that this employee is disengaged, right? So we've also seen ones where it's like you have a doorstop and you put the doorstop instead of taking out the wrapper, you just throw the doorstop in there with the package and everything. Well, I really like this picture. So I always show this as engagement. I had one manager stop me and go, Allie, have you ever used a paint truck? And I was like, come on, Tom, do you think I've ever used a paint truck? I can't even paint my own house. And he goes, well, what happens, Allie, is on those trucks, they have a ton of paint. If you stop, what happens is it all bunches up and then you get a big puddle of paint. And so actually the employee did the right thing. And I'm like, you're right. That's a great thing. I made the assumption that this employee was lazy and like, I'm not moving that log, right? But in fact, the employee probably made the best decision. So could that have conversation been, hey, why didn't you do that? You really should have moved the thing instead of being like, can you tell me about what happened? Or can you explain this? Or tell me a little bit about what was the reasoning behind this? Well, yeah, actually, Allie, the reason that I didn't move it is because I know that we're really on a tight budget with supplies, and I knew if I would stop that the paint would pile up and then we would be wasting a lot of supplies, and I also know that we've really been talking about not doing a lot of overtime, and then I would have had this big mess, and then I would have had to take overtime to clean it up and then bring back the shop, and then, you know, that's why I just did it. Okay, great, thanks, good answer, right? That's much different than jumping to our assumption. So it's always good to assume positive intent and ask those questions instead of just being accusatory. So we're gonna skip a break, but if you have to get up, feel free. I'm gonna briefly touch on FMLA, ADA, and all those fun laws, because really what I want you to know is enough to know when you need to bring something forward to HR. We are doing another seminar, I think next week, or a workshop, where we're gonna talk specifically about ADA and FMLA all day long. So you'll get to hear me for 2 hours talking about that. But really, FMLA, the Family Medical Leave Act, Americans with Disability Act, Genetic Information Non-Discrimination Act, Workers' Compensation and Employee Benefits, it's all kind of a big mess, right? So one impacts the other impacts us, and then we have all these things that we have to manage and know about. So it's really important for managers, if you're a manager, to know when to bring this information to HR. If you're in HR, it's really important that you help your managers know when they need to bring this stuff to you, because they need to know what your expectations are, because otherwise they can't meet them. So this is who it applies to. So FMLA applies to employers with 50 or more employees for 20 or more weeks in a year, if they have those employees in a 75-mile radius of each other. ADA is 15 or more employees. GINA is 15 or more. Workers' comp is one, even if it's just a part-time employee. And then various state and local laws also come into play, which is so fun for us. And that could be if you just have one employee. So it's really important that we know these things, just so we know we might have to take action. So FMLA, Family Medical Leave, really what that does, it allows employees to take 12 weeks off of work in a 12-month period for certain conditions. And that could be for the birth or son, birth of a son or daughter. It could be adoption or foster placement. It could be someone who has a serious health condition that we take care of. So it could be a son, daughter, spouse, someone we're directly responsible for. It could be a serious health condition that makes it so that we're unable to perform our job. Or it could be for certain types of military leave. So I'm not going to bore you with all that, because some of you might be coming to that seminar. But if you have questions, feel free to ask me afterward. But I really like this image, because this is a really good flow chart of what happens within FMLA. So the first thing we need to do is we need to post a notice. If you don't have a notice by your employees, posters with all the other federal laws, make sure you have one that talks about FMLA. There's a really steep fine of $110 if you don't have it. So
if it applies to you.
If FMLA applies to you. Employee notice. So the first thing is the employee comes to us and they say, hey, this is what's going on. Or we hear about it. We don't actually have to have the employee come up and say, I need an accommodation or I need FMLA. They don't have to know those words. We have to do something once we find out that it might be possibly an event. And we have 5 days from when we're notified to give the employee the eligibility and rights notices. The FMLA, so on the DOL, they have a ton of different worksheets. Use those. Don't make your own, please. Use those. They're there. They're there to guide you. If you need to include information like what to expect with pay, what to expect with benefits, please put that on a separate piece of paper. But these documents will help protect you to make sure you're following all the information that you truly need to give employees. So employee notifies us. We give them the eligibility and rights notice, give them that certification, and then they can fill out the certification form. So we know if it really is a health issue of themselves or their spouse or child or whoever it may be. And then we have another, they have 15 days to complete that. So we're kind of in this limbo, singing the Jeopardy song, waiting for them to turn that information back into us. And then we have 5 days to give them the designation notice. So the reason I'm pointing out the time frames is because it's so important for us to take action immediately. It's not like, oh yeah, we'll get to that, right? After I get to all the other things that I have to do. We have to meet those time frames. And then we give them the designation notice, they take leave, they come back to a same or similar position. So here are some things that we should never say to our employees, whether it's we're HR or manager. You can come back when you're fully released to work without restrictions, right? It seems innocent, but ADA comes into play and we might have to offer an accommodation depending on what the situation is. That's not our policy. It's great that you have a policy, but if it's really under the law, we should do that. She never said she was disabled, right? First of all, we shouldn't make that assumption. It doesn't have to be someone who has a full disability. And they don't have to say anything to us. We might have an opportunity to hear through the grapevine. There's no way she can do this job. We don't want to make that assumption. That's why we have the certification notice. Or you're getting older, you know. Kind of maybe we need to think about putting you in a different position. I don't want to say that. You've got to try these essential oils. Go to X Treatment Center. That's the only way you'll get through this. We never want to recommend care. I actually am hesitant to recommend care to my family because I'm like, oh, we're not supposed to do that. But I forget. You can do that personally. You can tell your friends where to go. But in the workplace, don't recommend care. You just want to say, gosh, thanks. How can we help support you, you know, through this process? Don't overshare, overask. Kind of as a manager, you want to know the least amount as possible. But managers and coworkers only need to know that the employee needs a lever or an accommodation, right? So managers can know I can't lift over 10 pounds, or I need to have my foot elevated, or I need to have water at my station. And then, you know, the other thing is avoid opinions or value statements in conjunction with that conversation, which is so hard for us as people, especially people who are really passionate and care about employees. We want to be like, oh, I'm so sorry that you're going through this. If you need anything, let's talk about it. We'll make sure your job's protected. We'll go through all these things, and you want to make sure that they feel better, but we don't want to make promises we can't keep. Use caution when using fitness for duty tests, especially if you don't do any pre-type of higher physicals. Probably not appropriate to do it now. ADA broadly defines disability was amended in 2008, and they actually broadened the definition to make it even more unclear for us what is meant by disability. Excuse me. So there are things like silent disabilities, things like major life impairments such as learning, concentrating, or communicating. And so that can be things like anxiety disorder as well. So reasonable accommodation. So that was a question before. What is a reasonable accommodation? Well, it's a modification or an adjustment to the work or the job itself that allows the individual, either the disabled individual or thinking about this even through a religious accommodation, to perform the essential functions of the position, right? So if we think about, hey, you know what? This desk isn't high enough to get my wheelchair. Okay, let's make an accommodation. We'll raise up the desk, right? Easy enough. Or I'm hard of hearing. I might need safety protection for if I go into a foundry or somewhere loud. That's an accommodation as well. Qualified individuals still need to be qualified to do the job. So we don't have to hire someone or make an accommodation for them if they're not qualified for the position itself, right? So we don't need to just fit everybody into every job. You have to be qualified for it itself. If an employee is injured, so a lot of times we have work comp claims, the biggest thing is if you're running FMLA concurrently with your workers' compensation, make sure you have that in your employee handbook that we run leave concurrently. And I want you to say that for PTO, short-term disability, workers' compensation, we run those leaves concurrently. Same with Minnesota parental leave as well. So it's really important that you know that these all tie together. And again, we'll go more in detail with these next week. So red flags that trigger some action. An employee gets hurt at work, what do? Let's report it immediately. That might affect our work comp, right? An employee asks for an accommodation, ADA, right? They might need some help with, you know, I can't lift 10 pounds or my doctor says X, Y, Z. An employee is acting different and you're unsure if it's a medical situation or substance abuse, right? Could that be an accommodation? Could that be reasonable suspicion if you have drug testing in place? What do we need to do? An employee threatens another employee, right? Do we have a zero tolerance policy that says, hey, no threatening? An employee posts an inappropriate picture in their locker. Could that be a harassment case? Right, so there's so many things that we have to do as an employer just to be aware of our work environment and see if we need to take action. We could literally sit here for days on end talking about if this happens, you should do this. We just want to give you enough information here to know, hey, we might need to do something. That might need to trigger some action. So some reminders, think before you speak, which is super hard, especially because we sometimes just want to, we're going. But think before you speak. Bring concerns or questions to HR or to other senior leadership immediately. You can still expect your employees to meet performance expectations. Just because someone's on work comp, just because they're on FMLA or they come back or they have a disability, you can still expect people to meet those performance expectations. They're not protected from everything, right? And again, it's not really tying our hands from that. And it's important, the biggest thing I want you guys to know is if FMLA doesn't apply to you, ADA might. So even if someone can't return for those 12 weeks that they have off from FMLA, we might have to do an accommodation. Keep notes, documentation. Here's a picture of that notepad that you're gonna buy everybody. You can also do email. Send yourself a quick email. It's time dated, stamped, all that, and just send it to yourself. You can put it in a person's electronic file, or you can put it in your own, or you can even print that off, whatever you like. Again, document facts, not opinions, which is super hard because we're human beings. And don't put those in the separate in the employee's personnel file, especially if it has medical conditions on it, things like that, requests for accommodations, you want a separate file for that.
Okay. All right, that was a lot of information, FMLA, ADA, work comp, lots of stuff. So let's switch into something a little bit lighter. Let's talk about some retention and engagement. When you guys go to a party, what's the first one of the first few questions somebody asks you or you ask them? Where do you work? What do you do? Right? People like to talk about what they do.
They even do it on The Family Feud.
Allie's addicted to the Game Show Network. Mm-hmm. So why does employee engagement matter, and what is it? It's a heightened emotional and intellectual connection that an employee has for their job. And it influences them to put more effort into their work. An engaged employee feels a positive connection to the employer, and they care more about their work over the long term. One thing you might want to listen for with engaged employees, how do they describe your organization? Do they say they or we? We do this, or they do this. It's a good measure. It's something we need to be aware of because the state of the American workplace is 70% of our employees are coming to work and they are not engaged. So that means 30% of your workers are engaged. Only 30%. The business impact, if you have workers that aren't engaged, that possibly 70%, they're going to be absent more. It's going to affect your productivity. So it's really important to have good, to have engaged workers. And across the generations, you might say, oh, I bet traditionalists and baby boomers are more engaged than Gen Xers or millennials. Not so. They have about the same engagement scores across the board. Looking at the U.S., I found this yesterday, and I find it quite staggering.
We're in trouble, guys.
We're in trouble. Look at Minnesota. This is sad. The lowest engagement.
So now moving to Florida. One more reason.
That's right. The two janitors story. Okay, so let's say these two companies are across the street from one another. They do the exact same work. They pay exactly the same. But company A treats their janitorial staff like it's no big deal. They don't really provide much value. They don't do much of anything. But let's say company B across the street really values what the employees do. You keep us safe. You keep our floors, you know, mopped. If there's puddles, you take care of them. What employee do you think would be more engaged, even if they have the same commute and they're paid the same? The employee that works at company B, the managers that actually see value in their work and express that to them? Absolutely. Another story is my garbage man. Who thinks about their garbage man on a daily basis? Well, I think about him today, every Thursday. I normally forget to bring my can down to the street. I have two able-bodied children that seem to forget as well. But when I forget, Tony, my driver, goes up to my house and picks up my garbage can, takes care of it. Tony is an engaged employee. Tony's been my garbage man for 13 years. Every holiday season, I send him a card. I call the company and thank them for him. He is an engaged employee, right? He's going the extra mile. He's taking an extra step. He doesn't have to do that. It's my fault. It's our fault if we didn't bring our can down to the street. But what an engaged employee.
And Jen always talks about how, you know, other companies are like, oh, we can save you money. She's like, you don't have Tony.
That's right. I get the calls all the time. I'm like, no, sorry. You don't want to save money? Nope, I want Tony.
I want Tony because he's going to make sure that I'm taken care of.
Yep.
And that's what's so important. You know, I want to go back to the slide real quick because I think this is what's such a missed opportunity, especially for us who talk about we have a hard time recruiting. Well, we also have a hard time with our current employees because we're not getting the most out of them because they're not fully engaged. So it's really important for us as managers that we help them get to that next step so that they're like Tony. They help us have better customer service. They help make sure that we retain our customers and our clients.
Yeah.
Is there any explanation? It seems like the southern region of the U.S. seems to be quite engaged, which I think for us in Minnesota is kind of the opposite of what it should
right.
be.
Right.
What we would perceive. Yep. Yep.
No, I think
nope.
It has something to do with the sun.
January. Yeah, maybe this was done in January or February when we have no sun.
Good question. Right. I think it also might have to do with unemployment rates, you know, benefits that are required, you know, taxes, things like that. I think there's a lot of things that kind of come into play that maybe we can't affect. But I think a big thing is what companies are residing in those states. Are they big companies that maybe you lose that human element? Or is it they're the more, you know, if you think about Minnesota, we have tons of big companies that are out of here. And I don't know if those are the ones who are affecting that or not. But I'm just trying to think what is affecting that. Good question, though.
Yeah, it's fascinating.
Yeah. So what's a team? It's a team that works together. And engagement. It's really important for us when we're talking about engagement to make sure that we have an effective team. And that starts with a manager. And there's a lot of things that managers can do and HR can do to help support this. And a lot of it is really just playing on people's expertise, knowing who has a strong skill set and giving people an opportunity to develop upon that skill set. So not always going to Jen and saying, Jen does this really well, so Jen's just going to have all those projects. Or Jen does that really well, so she's going to get all the crap projects because she always fixes them. Right? So we're balancing out that work and we're also giving people opportunities. It's really getting to know each other. Are you encouraging employees to get to know each other? I just did a team building event at one of my clients yesterday, and we sat down and I have a dice game that I make them play and answer personal questions about themselves. People who have worked together for 20 years, they still find out something different about each other that they didn't know before, right? So how can we help support each other so that we're building those relationships? Can we have group outings? Can we have, hey, let's all go to a movie or let's do this? Can we create some of those friendships as well? And have a consensus of your team's purpose. Have you guys actually sat down with your team and said, what's our purpose? What's our why or our goal within the organization? Do you have goals? Do you let employees sit in on those goals and make those results? So it's having a conversation as a team and saying, what do we want to accomplish over the next year? How do we get there? And then being on the same page. So I had a group that I worked with that we had some struggles within the team. Not everybody was on the same page. So we sat down and we spit out words of what we thought was it was important to do to be effective. So then we gave them a list and now they have that hanging by their time clock. Hey, these are the important things that we need to do to make sure that we're working together. So we talked about effective teamwork. Establish rules. Again, people will only get away with what you allow them to. So make sure that you're creating that environment that people want to be. Foster that open, respectful communication. I really like mindful behavior because what happens, we're in our jobs and we're doing stuff and we're going through the motions and we forget to stop and be mindful. Am I being mindful of how my nonverbals match what I'm saying to my employees? Am I mindful about how this person's perceiving what I'm saying? Am I being honest? Am I participating myself? So a lot of great organizations have awesome wellness programs or initiatives to help build that culture. But if your manager's not going to support it, are you going to feel like you should go? Nope. Right? So as a manager, too, are we leading by example? Harmful behavior, it's allowing people to criticize each other, having sub conversations, you know, people are spreading gossip, name callings, going off on tangents in meetings, getting redirecting the conversation or dominating a conversation. So as a manager, those are things that we want to be aware of. This is probably one of my favorite pictures. Is it a 6 or is it a 9? It's both. Yeah, absolutely, it's about perception. And this is most of the time why our organizations fail. It's because people are looking at it from different points of view and we forget that it's okay that we have different points of view. Because it's true, right? It's a 6 and a 9, doesn't matter. That's why playing cards is so hard. And they have to add the little shapes. So communication, there's 4 different areas that we communicate, right? It's thinking, it's listening as a manager. It's really important for us to listen to our employees. Same with HR. It's speaking, it's our tone of voice. It's the words that we choose. And then it's nonverbal communication. Nonverbal communication is actually 65% of your message, so that actually matters more than the words that you say. I want you guys all to read this email up here real quick. Just read it to yourself. Okay, how do you think that came across? How many of you thought it was pleasant? Or okay, neutral? Yeah. How many of you thought he was really rude and sarcastic and annoyed? How many of you are like, I don't really know? Yeah. I read this and I'm like, wow, Greg's kind of a jerk. He didn't say, hi, Allie. You know, and that's sort of like when people use ellipses, I'm like, oh gosh, why are you saying dot, dot, dot? Come on. That's rude, right? But that's the importance of nonverbal communication. And so when we're sending messages, are we aware of how that's going to be perceived? When we send messages to our employees or a text, what does that look like? And I think we need to be aware of that, because to Greg, he was probably happy, right? And some of you were like, yeah, he's fine, whatever. Other people are like, no, he didn't, right? And so it's really important that we're aware of how those messages come across and know what's important for us to be able to say face-to-face versus in an email. Conflict, a lot of times people think of conflict as a negative thing, but it's really a good opportunity for us to teach teamwork and get our employees to work together and overcome those things. As a manager's job, you have to interfere, and you have to say, hey, what's going on? Let's sit down. Let's talk about this. I noticed there's some tension. And then helping employees get over that, because sometimes they need that assistance. How to handle conflict? Talking to the other person, not letting it fester. So if an employee comes to you and says, I have this issue with Jen, instead of being like, okay, I'll handle it, I'll talk to them. Well, how do you think you could approach Jen? What do you think you could say to her? Right? Helping them have those conversations, because otherwise there's a lot of hurt feelings that the employee went to the manager, right? And the manager has to have that conversation. So it really fosters that better communication. Focus on behaviors and events, not personalities, because we don't want to personally attack anybody. Listening, right? Listening is just as important as documenting.
And it's not waiting for your turn to talk.
Yes, yes. So listening is not just sitting there being like, okay, I'm going to say this, I'm going to say this. It's really changing your message to listening what they have to say. Identify points of agreement and disagreement. So just so we're on the same page, you're saying this and we just don't agree on this, or we can't agree on this. Prioritize areas of conflict. Okay, what is something that we feel like we need to address today or that we can't get past? What are some things that maybe we can revisit in a couple weeks? Develop a plan to work out the conflict. Well, we're going to do X, Y, Z, right? Well, I don't feel like she has as much of a workload as I do. Well, I don't feel like that's true. Okay, well, what can we do? How can we look at that? Follow through on your plan. As a manager, check in. How are things going? What can we do to continue to support you through that? And build on your success. Look for opportunities to point out progress to employees all the time that they're making improvements. Make notice of those. People handle conflict in different ways. We have people who collaborate, right? So they're actually pretty high in concern for themselves or assertiveness, but then they're also concern for others is high. And that's really great. We love when people can collaborate, right? They care about themselves and they care about others. Sometimes we get people who are really low on that list for concern for themselves and for others, and they're like, I would rather just run out in front of the street instead of having to have this conversation, right? Like, and that's okay. Everybody has a different style. There's no right or wrong way. We just need to learn how to help our employees at whichever step they're in. So then there's also competing, not settling for anything less. We might have people who you're like, come on, buddy, we got to get you to collaborate just a little bit. It's not all about you. We have a team environment. Accommodating people who give into the demands of other. Maybe they don't care enough about, they're not assertive enough. Maybe we need to help them develop some of those skills. Compromising, meeting in the middle, where we just kind of find that neutral position where we both can be happy. Anybody ever been to Pike's Place in Seattle? Yeah, tell me about that experience. Awesome. Yeah. So for those of you who don't know, it's a marketplace in Seattle, and what they're known for is for their culture and their environment, for not only for their employees, but then also for their customers. So you see right here in this picture, there's a guy who is throwing a fish. And so I don't know about you, but there is everywhere else I'd rather work than a fish market, because when I was little, my parents would take me to Duluth and we'd always get fish and they would wrap it in newspaper and then put it next to me in the car. So I have horrible memories of fish. So that to me is not a good place to work, but they make it seem fun, right? It's cold, it rains. We should look at what Seattle's engagement was, right? It rains there all the time, but they have fun because what they choose to do is to play, be there, choose their attitude, and make the customer's day. And what they say is, hey, do we want to say this is a lousy stinking job, or do we want to be world famous? What do we want to do? And it's choosing to show up and be awesome. And as managers, you can implement this within your own department. This could be a recognition program. This could be an opportunity for you to say, what can we do to increase this? So play, tapping into your natural way of being creative and having fun. It allows curiosity and enthusiasm. So what can we do? Can we have a really cool challenge to raise money for charity? Or what can we do to help increase our clients? Can we send them out a funny little gift with our Christmas picture or whatever it is? What can we do to have fun in the workplace? And what can we do on a day-to-day basis? Does anybody have fun in their workplace? What do you guys do? Anybody have any cool stories? We have a ping pong table. So you can use that if you want to have ping pong. tournaments. We do that every year. It gets pretty competitive.
Hot dish competitions.
Yeah, hot dish chili competitions. You could do team building things where you do, you know, activities together. Mm-hmm. Good. Be there. Are we mindful or are we mindful? Right? So when we're actually talking to people, are we actually being there and listening to them? So I have a four-year-old nephew, and my brother-in-law was telling me a story. He's like, I got in big trouble the other day. And I was like, oh, what'd you do? He's like, well, he was talking to me. And he was going on and on and on, you know, like a four-year-old does. And he says, Dad, are you listening to me? And I'm like, yeah, yeah, yeah. So he keeps talking, At the end, he goes, so, Dad, can we do it? And he's like, do what? He's like, Dad, why weren't you listening, right? And so that happens a lot of the times, right? We're there, but we're thinking about, oh, gosh, I got to get this checked off before I go. I got to get home. I have to get the kids. I got to cook this. I got to do this, this, and this. So are we really being there and being present? It's emotionally being present for people, and it sends a powerful message of respect. So when you're talking to your employees or you're talking to employees of your organization, do you shut your computer off or just, you know, close the monitors, put your phone down? Are you answering calls when someone's in your office? Are we really being present? That sends a big, powerful message. If we have those one-on-one time scheduled, do we show up on time or let them know we're not going to be able to be there? Right? That's really important. Make their day. It's about valuing the people that you work for and constantly finding ways to show how much you appreciate them. Saying, wow. Jen, how many times yesterday did I tell you how much I appreciated you?
A lot.
A lot, right? And that's what it's about. It's telling people that you actually appreciate them for showing up and doing the job, right? It's not just saying, well, it's your job. You should do it. I shouldn't have to thank you. But it's instead showing up and really valuing the people. We think it a lot of times. We're like, that was awesome that they did it. Let's tell them and show them. So we'll make their day. And choosing our attitude. This is the one thing that we all have an opportunity to say. Someone said a positive was important, a positive leader. Choosing our attitude is taking responsibility for the way that we do our work. It's choosing to wake up. It's choosing to say, hey, you know what? Things aren't going well right now, but we're going to get back on track. We can do this together. Because if the leaders don't have that within the organization, employees don't either, right? My manager thinks this is the worst place to be. Why do I want to be here? Oh, my gosh, we have all these problems in the organization. Oh, I'm going to go look somewhere else, right? And I really like this. There is always a choice about the way you do your work, even if there is not a choice about the work itself. So we all have parts of our job that we don't necessarily love, right? There's things that we would love to get rid of or give to someone else, but that's not reality. So how do we choose to show up and choose the path that we're going to be awesome, we're going to have this a great place to be, and choose our attitude? And we also have performance management and career development as our next stage.
Yep. So, wow, I'm so excited for my performance appraisal today. That's what all the employees say, right? And as managers, we say it too when we're writing it. No, we don't. We don't love doing it. But why does it matter? We want to spotlight good work. We want to correct poor performance. We want to set expectations. We really need to assess the talent of our team. It supports employment decisions. So if you give everybody a C, or maybe a rating of 3 on a 1 to 5 scale, and then you need to terminate them, what happens? They've gotten 3s all the way through. Maybe it doesn't look so great, right? So we want to really make sure that we're rating employees in the right way so it will support employment decisions that we might need to make. It's going to increase our productivity, have less turnover, and open doors to communicate. We want managers and employees to communicate. It's a part of being an effective leader. Better business results show that we'll have 50% less turnover, higher customer service ratings, higher employee commitment ratings, so higher engagement, and wouldn't it be nice to have more net profits? So managing performance leads to all of those things. And it's not just a performance appraisal. It's not just that. We need to manage our top performers. They have expectations. We need to also sometimes manage those bottom performers and help them go work somewhere else. But really, it's about training and development. We need to train and develop our employees, give them ongoing education, give them feedback to how they're doing. And that equals performance management. Like I said, it's more than the review. It's managing the good and the bad, and then doing that annual review. This is our favorite part of the presentation. Don't leave it. Stay on it. Does anybody remember the left shark?
Left shark is supposed to move.
So. He is moving. He was.
Oh, he was? He's not on my screen. Okay, good. I'm glad you get to see left shark.
I have no idea what I'm doing. I love it. We don't want to micromanage our people. We want to give continuous coaching and give that feedback. They want that. And it doesn't always have to be formal. It can be informal. We want to just have those conversations, those check-ins. We want people to know what they're doing. They don't want to be the left shark. That poor guy. And giving feedback, provided immediately and in a private location if it's something that needs to be addressed. We don't want to do it when we're mad. We want to chill out a little bit. Sometimes the 24-hour rule is our friend, so we just can sleep on it. You might only have one chance to have this conversation. So be ready, be prepared. Talk to the employee about what their view on this situation is. And avoid things like always or never. Don't say things like sloppy or messy. We want to make sure that we're delivering this message again, clear and concisely. We've said it a ton, but it's important. Focus on what the person did or did not do. So don't focus on them personally, focus on the work. And when we're giving feedback, we want to do it in a feedback sandwich way. We want to layer it with positive, then our negative or our opportunity, and then positive again, right? That's how I try to do it with my kids when I'm talking to my youngest about his math grade.
She's really good at it. I hear these conversations all the time. Yeah. So if you need help, Jen will help you. We're in this situation where we're really in a different way of thinking. And I think this is my favorite picture because it's a boss versus a leader, right? So a boss is someone that we're following, you know, and they're just like us. But the leader is someone who's among us and they stand out, right? So it's someone who's doing the work with us. It's not saying, hey, you're so busy, I'm sorry, that sucks. But it's how can I help you? What can I do to help support that? It's developing our team, encouraging professional growth, and keeping that on the forefront of your mind always, and maybe keeping that in your budget. The other thing that we have to do as employers is remember our falling stars, our middle stars, and our superstars, right? So falling stars, if we can't coach and develop them, we might need to get them off the bus. Our middle stars, we need B players, right? We need people who are consistent. They might not want to grow and develop into something else, but they're going to be solid players for us. But then also, like we talked about earlier with engagement, our employees who are awesome superstars, what are we doing to keep them so when recruiters are calling them, they're not picking up the phone? So great performance, really what that is, how we manage that, is if employees have a lack of skill, we need to train them. So training is not always the solution. And sometimes we think, oh, well, we'll just train them. We'll give them a training class. If it's a lack of will, they might need motivation. What can we do to motivate them intrinsically? Coaching, that helps with their focus. Most people do not use their talents at work at all. And I think that's because sometimes we don't know what they are and how to play to them, and sometimes people are just too shy to tell us. So it's really important that we're aware of, hey, what are you good at? What do you want to do more of? How do we get you there? Career development, it's a must-do. It's something that you have to do to keep and retain your employees. Because that's the world that we live in now, especially with the new workforce. That's what the expectations are.
So if we need to move those bottom performers out or get them off the bus, how are we going to separate and transition them out of the organization? Do you have an exit process? Do you have a termination checklist? Anybody have a termination checklist? There's lots of things we need to do at a point of termination, right? There's lots of things we need to collect, lots of things we need to check off our list. I would recommend highly having an exit interview or exit checklist.
And let your managers know what the process is.
Yep.
So the worst thing is for a manager to be sitting in a meeting and someone says, I'm quitting, and then be like, okay, what do I do? Right? That's really unfair for the manager to be in that situation. So we need to coach and develop them. Here's what we expect. Here's our process. Because that's going to make them feel more comfortable. And we want to put them in a situation for success because we care about our manager's engagement as well.
Yep. Are we consistent in applying our rules? So that's why we go back to the, you know, if we want to terminate somebody, it depends. It depends on our past precedents, depends on our policies. It could be an it depends situation. Is this the worst violation of blank policy that I've ever seen? Have I seen worse but not terminated? Again, it could be it's a depends situation. Have you already discussed this issue already with the employee? Have you had a verbal, a written warning, a final? Have they been put on a performance improvement plan? When you terminate, do not make that decision to terminate alone. HR people support managers in that. Managers go to HR people to make that decision because it's not something you should take lightly and it's not something that you should do alone. We need to consider those fun employment laws that I had the privilege of talking about at the beginning. We've got the federal laws and the Minnesota state laws that affect us. And if you have multi-state, those laws will impact you as well. So in summary, we know that being a manager, whether you're an HR manager or a manager of people, that there's a lot of challenges. We challenge you to bring out the best in your people. It's hard, but how are we going to deal with those underperforming employees? On the same hand, we've got those high maintenance, outstanding employees. What are we going to do with them? We need to hire the right people. We spent a good portion of today talking about that. That's really hard work. We have to respond in a crisis. How do we know what those red flags are that we need to do something with? We need to continuously improve. We possibly need to train. Time is never on our side, right? How often do you get to work and look up and it's 1:30 already? All the time for me. We need to really listen to our employees and have those meaningful conversations. We want you to leave today with those employment law basics. We want you to consider training more and maybe developing that mentor program. Document, document, document. Get your notebooks out. Stop on the way back to the office and get those managers, those notebooks to carry around with them. Investigate. Get HR involved if you hear any of those red flags, FMLA, ADA, reasonable accommodation, somebody seems impaired in the work environment. Be a leader more than a boss and never terminate alone.
So we just have some final things for you guys to take a look at. You know, this is really what great leaders are. It's people who share information. It's people who give thanks and share the credit. It's empowering through delegation, but not just passing off the crap work, right? So it's giving meaningful work and opportunities, but not just saying, here, you do this. It's adjusting your style to theirs. You know, just like we talked about, setting small goals or milestones for them, especially, you know, in that first couple weeks. It's giving honest and open feedback, removing some of the obstacles that get in an employee's way. Having fun, right? We talked about playing when we talked about the fish philosophy. It's about playing and having fun and making it a place where people feel like, hey, we can have fun at work. We still get our job done, but we're going to have fun. Raising your hand, you know, allowing yourself to do the work too, knowing exactly what employees do and help them. And then focusing your time, you know, focus your time on the right things. What are you picking your battles about? You know, is it we're really helping develop our employees, or are we picking battles that maybe are a little bit irrelevant? Does anybody have any questions for us? I know we're about 3 minutes over. Okay. Well, thank you guys so much for your time and coming in today. We really hope that there was some stuff that you guys learned. We know it's kind of like drinking from a fire hose. But we'd be glad to answer any questions if you have any. But otherwise, thank you so much for your time today. Have a great rest of the day.
Thanks, everybody. Thank you.